What's up, everyone, and welcome back to the Fast Life Podcast. Great show with my buddy Kyle. I caught him on the way back from Milwaukee on the new Road Glide. Let me stay at his house. He's got a really rad shop, and we're going to talk all about that in this podcast. But before we get into it, you guys got to know about Simpson Motorcycle Helmets. They have a phenomenal product that's kick-ass, looks badass, and won't break your bank. So check them out at Simpson Motorcycle Helmets on Instagram and SimpsonMotorcycleHelmets.com. You can catch the Thundermax team over at Black Hills Harley-Davidson during the 81st Sturgis Rally. They will be installing Thundermax ECMs, M8 cooling fans for touring models, and iRide rear suspension systems. They are offering free installs, and yes, you can name drop our Fast Life offer code in person, which will save you 10%. Our code is always accepted on shoptmax.com, so no worries if you're not making Sturgis this year. And while you're at it, give these guys a follow on Instagram at ThundermaxEFI. While in Sturgis, you can slide over to the Big Engine Bar at the Buffalo Chip, where you can pick up the all-new Lexan G16. You guys have heard all about the amazing features this unit has, like Bluetooth 5.0, music sharing, and up to 16 rider comm system. You can go to their website, lexan-moto.com, or better yet, go see them in Sturgis at the Buffalo Chip. And drop the Fast Life offer code online or in person to get yourself 15% off your entire order. Joining the Lexan family is a smart move of 2021, and you're not going to find another Bluetooth headset company that can touch Lexan's customer service or match their overall support for our motorcycle scene. Damn straight. While in Sturgis, stop by and see our friends at Electric Lighting Co. They will be set up at the JP Cycles in Sturgis off Lazelle Street. They will have a fully interactive display so you can see in person the electric lighting difference. They will be offering free installs on most electric lighting and Badlands products purchased at the rally. If you drop our name Fast Life with your purchase of $75 or more, they will be giving away a free t-shirt while supplies last. Find out more about Electric Lighting Co. by visiting namscustomcycleproducts.com and giving them a follow on Instagram at Electric Lighting Co. You can catch the S&S Cycles team at Black Hills Harley-Davidson, where you'll be able to buy and have installed a handful of their products. Stop by, tell them you heard about them on the Fast Life podcast, shake their hand, grab some swag, and don't forget to follow these guys on Instagram at SS Cycle and check out their products on their website, sscycle.com. A lot of great stuff to get your motorcycle performing at its peak ability. Is that a word? Anyway, check them out. Great guys, and I'm looking forward to doing more with those guys in the future. Like I said before, this podcast is with my buddy Kyle. Kyle started a new shop called Forever Rad, and he's building his shop as we speak. And he's already built some of the best and most iconic performance baggers in our scene over the last couple of years. And he's got a whole list of more coming. So I'm really stoked to sit down and just go over the many different topics we went through in this podcast, sipping whiskey and catching up at his new shop. So let's get into it. Here's Kyle with Forever Rad.
Hey guys, you ready to let the dogs out?
Fast Life Podcast.
I think we're good. Forever Rad, brother.
Hey.
Cheers. Cheers. Yes. We're too far to cheers.
I'll come to you.
Look at my eyes, is almost melted already.
It's that fucking fire-ass whiskey in here.
Yeah.
Creek water.
Mark Norton calls that gravy.
Mm.
When the water melts, he says, get you some more of that gravy. You got to get some more gravy on that.
Awesome. Well, dude, this shop is... I've been here like almost 2 hours, I think, now. And it's literally just been like a, hey, check out this room. Check out this spot. Yeah. it's like a big kid's clubhouse is what it feels like.
It is. It's like a fantasy factory,
mm-hmm.
basically, minus the foam pit. It does have a skate park. It's in the works.
Yeah.
It's happening. But you didn't even see the second level yet.
No, I can't do stairs right now. After I just walked your driveway, I got enough workout for the rest of the day. No, man, this place is awesome, man. So, you know, for sure, congratulations. Like,
thank you.
This whole deal is like anybody that ever sees this, this is like a dream shop mm-hmm. for anybody that does the kind of stuff we do. You know what I mean?
Yep. It's very surreal.
Yeah.
Very surreal. It's been, you know, it still doesn't necessarily feel like home quite yet. I would say it's, I don't know. It's almost, it's like I'm on vacation, but I'm working for like 14 hours a day. So there's nothing vacation about it.
Yeah, but this probably feels way different because it's like you own this. So every improvement, everything you do, it just adds to, like, you know, you're not doing it for somebody else. It's all for you.
Yeah, I'm at the point now where there's so many projects that you get to a point where you're like, well, that's going to be one of those future projects. Mm-hmm. And this is going to be an ongoing project. And so then if you really break all that down, I just have years of projects ahead of me. And that gets to be overwhelming thinking about that. But then it's also it's a little less stressful when you put it that way, because you're like, well, I got time. It's no big deal.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So, but I'm such a doer that I like making shit. I like seeing progress. I like feeling the progress. So I just don't stop. I just keep going, keep going, keep going. But
it's a good therapy though. Cause I mean, if I had this and I didn't like feel the need to, you know, go to the bar or go out all the time, you know what I mean? Because I have like something that so many different projects that are so valuable to my livelihood, like working on a shop. It's kind of like whenever we were building and remodeling ours.
Like when you built your podcast.
It was literally every night till 3 a.m. Like it was like, for one, like I got to do it with my friends and you know, that alone was kind of like it was almost like the same feeling I have when I ride across country with a couple dudes. The time we spent in that shop till 3 a.m, you know, turning empty space into something, like, dude.
I get that. And so that's why it's hard for me to not just try and get it all done, because I just keep going. And it's like, okay, boom, cross it off the list, on to the next one. The list is so long that it gets to be overwhelming. But it's been like 2 months. I've been out here every day, going nonstop. That's the biggest problem, is I don't have a lot of help. Like you said, the homies are there to help out. You have this bonding experience, and it's fun in that sense. I don't really have any help here. So I have plenty of friends, but it's an hour from where I used to live.
Yeah.
Which, to me, I've done that drive 100 times now, so it's nothing.
Yeah.
You know, it's I actually enjoy it now going back to where I live, because it's the perfect time to catch up on phone calls. That dreaded, fuck, this is going to take an hour to call him today. Perfect. I'm going to call him when I head back over to the old place in Illinois. Yeah. So I've been using that appropriately, but it's hard to get people out here. I hate to put it this way, but it's almost like I have to find new friends closer here, which sucks, because I already have such a good circle that's tight, right?
Well, you know, I was talking to somebody. This is something I brought up millions of times, but it's not to take away from the fact that a lot of great friends come out of this, but it's crazy how much of your life revolves around convenience, and sometimes it's friends.
True.
Like, man, like that's my best friend, but it's like, well, is he your best friend? What if you move across town?
Very true.
Not to say that dude's a piece of shit or anything, but just to say, like...
So my mother-in-law, she made a statement a few years ago to me. I have so many friends. I really do. I have so many friends that I really consider very close friends. People that would give you the shirt off your back. But she goes, you know, by the time you're my age, 60, 65, whatever, you won't be able to count all your friends on one hand. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, fucking whatever, like... That's a bold statement. Yeah. I got a lot of friends. Well, just moving out here has been an eye-opener, because it's like, no one is just a phone call away anymore. It's they now have to commit at least 2 hours of driving to get over here on top of the time they spend over. So, or the time that they're here. So it's like, I'm going to struggle with that, because I enjoy having people just swing by, pop in, hey, how are you? I mean, you know, it sucks when you get people that stop in during the day and kind of take away from your work day. Mm-hmm. That sucks. But just to have people come over and have a beer with you or whatever. I mean, I don't drink beer. I drink coffee, but
you know, yeah, but like, I know what you mean. Cause I mean, my shop's kind of on the outskirts too. So fortunately sometimes like, it's like, I don't cry wolf a lot, right? Mm-hmm. Like if I'm going to do something, I want all the friends to come out. I make sure that like it's going to be worth their time.
Yeah, you make it a thing, right?
Yeah.
Like, all right, so Saturday, let's do this.
Yeah, because it's not like down the street for them either.
Right.
So they make the effort to do that here and there. And
and that's cool too, because you can kind of keep it as more of an exclusive kind of thing where if you enjoy your, not freedom, but you enjoy your space where you don't want to be around a bunch of people every day, that is kind of nice too. It does get a little boring out here though. That's why I put this TV up. I've been against TVs in shops from day one. Like, if you have a couch and a TV, you're not working hard enough. End of story. You're not going to change my mind. But now that you stream music on a TV, think of all the times I've looked up a YouTube video for how the fuck do you put this together.
Yeah.
I'm like, all right, I'll do it on a TV now. Well, now I'm seeing this as an opportunity of a form of entertaining people, kind of going back on my words. But going back what you said, this place is like, it has that feel. It's not just a shop. It's not just a garage. It's a hangout kind of spot if you want it
to be. Well, when you think about how much time you spend out here, like you know, originally, like when your shop is, you know, I think that I spend so much time in a shop that I want it to feel like my house. Like, I was thinking about the other day, actually last night or the day before, I was like, I have more stuff that's worth money in my shop than my house.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? And it's like, and I was thinking, I was like, if my house burned down, fucking cool. My shop burned down, I'm fucking finished.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's like,
We didn't talk about that last time about my shop burning down. Did we talk?
No.
Did we talk about that?
Mm.
No. I mean, I'll gladly talk about it, but I don't mean to interrupt you in the middle of
statement. I'm not. Yeah.
But at my last shop that you were at, I bought the house because of the garage that was there. It was big. It was like 30 by 35. I could finally fit a Cadillac inside of a garage. And a year after owning that place, I had just finished my dream car, which was a 59 Coupe DeVille. Dawn painted air ride, badass car. And it was one night, 2 o'clock in the morning. I shut down the shop at like 11, went to bed and woke up at 2 in the morning and the shop was on fire. The whole fucking thing. Like, too far gone, you're not saving shit. Grab your kids, grab your shit, and get out of the house before the house explodes, right?
Wow.
Because you've seen it, the garage is like 20 feet from the house. So it was just panic mode, especially when you wake up from a dead sleep. So I think the reason I wanted to bring this up is I rebuilt that shop, and I built it bigger, and that's kind of how I've gotten to where I'm at, is just nonstop work, just keep making shit happen every single day in my backyard. It's very productive way of life, right? Versus having to drive to that shop, planning your day with the commute and X amount of hours in the shop. It's the kind of thing where the kids can go to bed and I'll come back out and work till 2 in the morning. Nobody cares. Everyone goes to bed early anyways. I stay up late. So that's my most productive time is when no one's bothering me. But, with all that being said, that last shop burned down. And what happened with that is I lost. To me, it felt like everything, right? In the moment, my life's over. The next day, it wasn't the next day, but like a couple days after, it's really soaks in, holy shit, like everything's gone.
Yeah.
But then you're like, well, I have my home, I have my family, everyone's safe. Okay, things could be worse.
Yeah.
Although it couldn't have been worse. I mean, every tool, every memory. I had 2 cars. I had a 62 Impala on air ride plus the 59 Cadillac. I had, like, you know, the magazine features from the plaques, in the news plaques. I had those all over the walls from trucks I had built, cars. All that shit's gone. Every memory from day one.
What caught fire?
The fire department did their own investigation to determine whether it was arson, intentional, for insurance fraud and that kind of stuff. They deemed it undetermined. So to this day, I don't truly know. But it was a year after the fire. I was back up and running with the new building, and I was at some kind of party, St. Patrick's Day party or something, and a guy who builds my motors, at the time, he was building motors for cars for me. He goes, hey, how's the new shop going? I'm like, yeah, it's going good. And he goes, hey, did you ever figure out what caused that fire? And I'm like, no. Now, of course, at that time, I don't want to think about how often I've had to have this conversation. It was painful still, you know? Yeah. Like, no, I don't know. They didn't ever come up with the reason. And he goes, you know, did I ever tell you my best buddy built that garage, owned that house? I'm like, no, I didn't. He's like, yeah, his name's blah, blah, blah. I'm like, no, I didn't know that. He goes, yeah, you know, he used to drive race cars, like circle track cars, mm-hmm. Friday night, dirt track cars. And it clicked at that moment. The floor had chains built into the floor.
Yeah.
So you could hook up and pull, straighten out frames, pull body panels.
Yeah.
I'm like, who the fuck needs chains on their floor, right? It clicked. Okay, it's making sense. He goes, you know, there was a storm back in like 91 where the neighbor's tree, big ass tall tree, fell down, landed on the roof, collapsed the whole fucking roof on that building. I'm like, okay. He goes, I told him he needs to replace all that wiring in the attic because it's all stapled up to the rafters. And when the roof came down, it's, you know, rafters came down and all the wiring would have, I assume, would stretch out.
Yeah.
Because it's stapled up. He goes, he just stapled it back up and moved on with his life. He goes, I guarantee you that's why your shop burned down. And I like, dude, it hit me like a ton of bricks. Like I almost cried because it was at that moment I was being given the answer.
Yeah. Yeah.
So to answer your question, I was told that by someone who knows more than I do, but
do you think that after that took place, do you think it like it set you up for a different, better thing in life?
It did. Absolutely. It has transformed me.
Like it changed your mind?
100%.
Yeah.
I love collecting things. I had like autographed photos, you know, like my son Cash, he's named after Johnny Cash.
Yeah.
I had an autographed Johnny Cash photo. It meant the world to me.
Yeah.
I would collect oil cans, license plates, the typical gas pumps, that typical like memorabilia type stuff. I was a, you know, a major hot rod guy, so I was into that stuff. As soon as you, that shit means the world to you. But as soon as you have that taken from you, you quickly realize how much it is just stuff.
Yeah.
And a year later, you realize how much you don't actually miss it and how grateful for you are for still getting a second chance at doing this again.
Yeah.
I mean, imagine if that was my home. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
And it's the kind of thing where I'm definitely the, like, the poster child for, oh, that'll never happen to me, right? Like, I'm a good rider. I'll never get hit by a car. That, it's that whole, I'm never going to catch this crazy disease and get sick and die because of it. Like, that type of mentality.
Yeah.
It quickly changes you as a person. It makes you realize you're no longer invincible.
Mm-hmm.
And you kind of reevaluate how important just anything and everything is.
Do you think like going, you know, because there's a lot of those things that you just listed off are things that I think most people, especially like my age, start to worry about. Like, you know, I'm creeping on 40. And so I start thinking about like health and, you know, not necessarily diseases, but like, you know,
just
cancer, shit like that.
Sure.
And, you know, like I was telling you earlier how like I feel like a lot of moves right now have been kind of setting myself up for a lot more responsible things to do in my life.
Mm-hmm,
And it's always felt, even though I'm trying to give my new life credit, it feels like every time you take a couple steps towards something like to put yourself in a better place, it's like that's when things kind of...
Mm-hmm.
Now, don't get me wrong. Like the reason I asked you, like, do you feel like it changed you and made you for the better? Because every literal bad thing that's ever happened to me is always kind of... It's like... redirected me to somewhere to catch another wave.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean?
It's the whole thing of being a huge believer in karma and everything happens for a reason. This is also a reason why I try and just live my life a day at a time because it all matters, obviously.
Yeah.
But man, as quick as that happened to me, you never know. It doesn't even have to be my bike. I could be driving up the road in my truck tomorrow and it can happen that quick. Yeah. So you start to realize just how much like stuff doesn't matter.
Yeah.
The cars that I lost, I would deem the one, my Cadillac, was an absolutely irreplaceable car. It was my dream car. It was everything I've ever worked for from the day I was 14 years old till at the time I was 26. And I'm killing it at 26. I have my dream car. I mean, in this car, it was, catch me out, dude. Now it's gone, just like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I did have it insured and I got paid on it, but it didn't make up for it.
Yeah.
Like the money helps obviously, but it doesn't make up for losing that car.
Yeah.
But since then, I have built numerous cars, bought, sold, traded numerous cars, and that has helped me not become attached to anything. Nothing. It's all just stuff.
Yeah.
And so now I'm like anti-hoarder. Like, if I don't need it, get it the fuck out of my way.
Yeah.
Like, there's a garbage can over here that's got a sound bar and a subwoofer in it. I've owned it for 8 years. It works, but it sounds like dog. I hooked it up here in the shop. It sounds like shit. It's mm-hmm. not loud enough. It doesn't hook up with an optical cable. The sub's not wireless. Like, this thing is, dude, it's 2021. Like, there's so much cool shit out. I literally took it, threw it in the trash can. Why would I try and sell it on fucking Craigslist? Why would I see if anybody needs it? It's in my way. I'm trying to make progress. Get out of here.
Yeah.
Go get a new one. Boom, it's done. Stereo sounds awesome in here. So before that fire, I'd have never done that. I'd have set it up on the shelf. Someone's going to need this someday. Now, I would say that has done a lot of good things for me and also bad things.
Yeah.
One thing is, like, I'll say this to you as someone who used to skateboard yourself and someone who I still skate a lot. I have a whole box of skateboards right there.
Yeah.
And so as I'm getting a little older, being a little more cautious with my money, making the right investments, just in general, making a little more money, I'm starting to collect a little bit more. But it's taken me almost 10 years to finally get back in that mindset.
Yeah.
And that's all because of the fire, all mm-hmm. of it. But what I'm doing now is I'm collecting skateboards. And so they're near and dear skateboards that mean something to me. But then also, like, just cool looking skateboards for the wall.
Yeah.
Because I'm ready to, since I lost all my artwork in that shop fire, I've been collecting ever since then.
Yeah.
But just on, like, the rainy day fund, like, well, I got an extra couple hundred. I'll just pick that up. And so when I built the new shop, put metal walls inside of it mm-hmm. and I hung it all myself. I paid for it, cut it, put it up. You were not getting me to drill a hole in that sheet metal. No way, dude. Like, I just spent all this time and money. I'm not putting holes in this building.
Mm-hmm.
So I had this giant shelf and I just stacked it full of collectible stuff. Well, now I'm even more excited because I got like 8 or 9 years worth of collecting that I can finally hang up in this shop. So I'm like super amped on that. And I just got this place like painted to where now I'm ready to start putting holes in the walls and really start making it give it that home feel that you were talking about.
Yeah.
So super exciting stuff.
See, I'm at a point now because I've had my studio for going on 2 years now. Mm-hmm. Didn't even seem like that long, but it's,
yeah, I would agree. It doesn't seem like it's,
you know, long. It's I mean, technically a year and a half, but you know, let's just round it up.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so like I'm already at a point now where like I'm already dreaming of the next one. The next studio or what can I do to change it to make it, you know, more interesting, you know, whatever.
Right.
Because, you know, also like it's the studio where people see us doing the podcast, but it's also a room that I spend a lot of time in behind the computer doing different things, whether it's editing photos, editing podcasts or, you know, drawing stuff for the vinyl cutter.
Sure.
I spend a lot of time in there. So it's like part of me wants it to feel like my room, you know, like my...
Yeah, that makes sense. But are you running out of space in there?
Totally. Like, it's
so it's that's the biggest problem.
It's you know, obviously when we built it, we had constraints,
right?
That we had, but you know, the next shop is going to be a studio, not a shop, because the next shop I want to be behind my house.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So I'm trying to stay at this place for another 2 or 3 more years before we buy another house that has a little bit of land that hopefully has mm-hmm. at least a start.
Right.
Of a shop behind it.
Do you want to be able to still paint in there?
I want to paint at home because it's so expensive to put a paint shop in a commercial property.
Right.
That I would rather set it up for the house and do it that way so that, you know, like the painting is like you said, it's one of those things that like, to me, I got to feel it like for the art side of it. Like I got to be like, you know what? I really want to do this right now. And sometimes that happens at 10 o'clock at night.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah, it's definitely your title. I mean, you're known as a podcast guy, absolutely.
Yeah.
But first and foremost, you're known as a painter. I think you always will be.
Yeah, for sure.
Not to take credit from your podcast and the success of how far you've come with it, but when you're that talented, and that's what you were known for first, you're always going to be a badass painter.
Yeah.
And so, like we talked about earlier, you hate to waste the talent. and not paint. But then at the same time, I get it. Like, you got to be in the right mindset. You got to be ready to paint those new, fresh ideas. You got to really be feeling it to produce. And people don't realize that's what it takes to continue pushing forward.
What we were kind of getting to earlier, that I think we got sidetracked on something, but not to say I'm on a level or anything like that, because there's so many talented painters that I aspire to be, you know, Jeremy, sure, you know, Poland, all these guys, right? But when you get to a certain level, which I feel like I'm on, that you have this, like, this level that you have to keep up in the public eye.
Absolutely.
And so, you know, like, you can't really try shit.
Right.
You can't try shit on customers, and you kind of have to make time to try the new ideas and try that shit out. So that gets tough.
Absolutely. So perfect example is exactly where I'm at, sitting in the shop right now.
Yeah.
The Rogue King sitting over here. I did it to the best of my ability, to the best of my budget would allow. It turned out amazing, but I did a lot of stuff to that bike I wouldn't normally do for anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
Not to one up everyone, but just to showcase my talent, what I'm capable of.
Yeah.
Where my vision can allow things to go and how it can look different than most bikes. And it worked. But now I have people wanting me to do the same for them. And so, case in point, I have Mark's bike sitting over here. It's a fantastic motorcycle.
Yeah.
I made a post about it. Everybody says, that bike's done. That bike's amazing. I'd die for that bike. I would give my kid for that bike. And I'm like, yeah, I'm about to tear this down to a bare fucking frame. Like,
yeah,
keep your comments, because this bike is no longer, it doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
Forget about this bike at this point. When it comes out, it's a totally different motorcycle. And Mark wants it to the level of the Road King. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm fully capable, no doubt. But you have to have that in you. You got to be feeling it. Those right color combos and the next modification that no one's done on this portion of the frame or this part that no one else has made yet. And
yeah,
pushing those boundaries as building motorcycles.
Yeah.
Dude, it's exhausting. It's the shit that keeps you up at night. Just like, you know, going to work the next day, how am I going to do this? You're going to lay in bed the night before and think about it, so you're ready to go first thing in the morning.
Well, the way you can look at it and the way I do is that sometimes when you get opportunities like that, you know, it's a high profile bike that's mm-hmm. been, you know, it's made its rounds, you know, on social media platforms and shows and events. So it's kind of known.
Right.
The first performance CVO.
Absolutely.
There's definitely like a, like you want to follow it up to make sure that, you know, no matter what you do, no one's like, I like the way it should have just stayed a CVO.
Right. It has to be the bike justice. It's a very daunting task. It's very intimidating, and I'm not afraid of it, but I try to produce at a certain level of quality but also timeliness too. Yeah. Like, I'm not a big fan of like a 2-year bike build. Like, that's just ridiculous. Right.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to do it in a timely manner to keep not only myself, but also Mark happy, but also be pushing those limits on those one-off parts and the shit no one else has seen or done before. But also being known as somewhat of like the first CVO performance-based bagger out there, I want to keep that feel to the bike, mm-hmm. but also not keep it too CVO, because CVO, in my mind, is just a flex. Fuck you money. Like, I think it's really lame, honestly. So I have to dig real deep and figure out a way to give it a CVO feel, even though I'm not into CVOs.
Yeah.
Right? Like, that bike's being a CVO. Like, what's cool about the bike other than the fact that it's
expensive?
Yeah. I mean, the rocker box spacers were a different color. It's got a solid gray paint job. Like, gray's dope, but it's just gray. Like, nothing crazy.
I told him that for years. He never wanted to listen.
And then it had some different wheels on it. Like, really, what else is there? That's the dash and one, the fill hole for the gas, right?
Yeah.
Other than that, just the fucking Harley. Mm-hmm. So how do I keep that CVO feel moving forward? Well, we're clearly going to have to accomplish that in the paint job. It's going to have a CVO-ish kind of feel. As a painter, I hope you would, you can think what you want to think. I would hope that you would agree that like 30% of the CVOs look kind of cool.
Yeah, I think that they usually hit the nail on the head with CVOs, but I think that they outdid themselves with like the 2012 CVOs, Road Glides.
So you're going to say Skunk, right?
Yeah, Skunk and the Brown and the Gold.
Exactly where our inspiration is headed. Yeah. And I shouldn't be talking about that. It's not that it's a top secret thing, but yeah. Mark has talked a lot about that. And then when we think of Mark as...
Mark, as someone that's done a lot of stuff for Mark, he knows that he wants it chill and subtle, but loud.
Right, flashy.
You know what I mean? Flashy. He wants it flashy, but not like... It's like he's what I think it is, and I'm not trying to make fun of him because we do a lot of shit talking. That's my boy.
Right.
But he wants it to get people's attention, but he doesn't want it to look like he's asking for attention.
You don't need to notice it from 30 feet away, but he does want you to stop when you come up to it, for sure. Just like anybody who owns a motorcycle does, who cares about the appearance of it, obviously. I think my thing is being that Mark is older than us.
Mm-hmm.
He's like more distinguished, you know. I'm drinking creek water whiskey and you're drinking
creek water.
Yeah. But after that, we got some Jack Daniels. Mark would be drinking Blue Label Scotch. Yeah. Okay. So I'm drinking $30. He's drinking
$260.
Yeah. $300. So I want his paint shop to feel that way.
Yeah.
But not in like a, like, hey, look at me, but CVO feel, but detailed to death.
Well, it's a perfect example, right? So if you think about, you know, you've been involved in customization in anything motorcycle, automotive for years. Mm-hmm. And you can always tell when somebody has real money and the kind of shit that inspires them to want to do stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And people that are kind of like, probably us, like the guys that didn't have money, but we had the ability, so we make our shit wild and crazy.
Right.
So I remember, you know, growing up, and I used to do a lot of car stuff back in the day, and some, you know, one of the shops I was at, I don't remember much of the details of the story, but the point of the story was the guy said, you know, sometimes you just don't paint a BMW. You know what I mean? There's some things that just need to be what they are.
Sure.
You know? And so... And it kind of, you know, from that conversation hearing him, I was like, okay, so then I started looking at, you know, even with the truck world, you can attest this mini truck world and everything.
Yep.
When you would see full-size trucks done versus mini trucks done, sometimes the full-size trucks had a much more clean and classy thing. And then the mini trucks were like Swiss cheese and crazy. And it's just like a...
I agree. But I think a lot of that had to do with the demographic.
It is.
Yeah. The older guys, not that they were old, but... The young dudes were into the mini trucks. The little bit older guys, 10 years older than the mini truckers, were into the sport trucks, so full-size Chevys.
Yeah.
But to do custom paint on a truck, it's expensive, right? Well, every mini trucker has a homie that can do Swiss cheese graphics in his backyard, so they're just making it loud and crazy for as cheap as possible. Yeah. But to do an overall on a full-size truck, especially when you get into like crew cab dualies and color changes. Bro, I'm here to tell you, like, we've done paint jobs on full-size trucks that cost $20,000.
Yeah.
I mean, because it's a color change and it's fix this and modify that and shave this and then do full graphics through the jams, under the hood, all that shit. It's not uncommon to spend 10, 20 grand on a crazy paint job for a full-size truck. So a lot of times they stay cleaner because... Yeah. It's a giant truck, so people weren't throwing that money at the paint. They were throwing it at 26-inch billet wheels.
What about this now? Do you find yourself, I mean, like when it comes to the paint jobs that you would want to have yourself, because you have the ability to work with a lot of talented artists, like Jeremy, Poland, you know, Springle.
Uh-huh.
And so, like, do you tend to want to go more the clean route? Because, like, the challenge is clean.
Right.
Like, it's not like... There's no color in there that takes your eye off of it or stands out over anything. It's very pleasing to look at. You know what I mean?
Any paint shop that I do usually does have a color that is loud in my mind.
Yeah.
So on the Challenger, it's a bright blood red color.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to do that. It's kind of actually not blood. It's more like a red burgundy.
Yeah.
It doesn't belong. Definitely.
Yeah.
But I wanted to keep somewhat of a vintage Indian feel to it.
Yeah.
So I kept that because you think of a vintage Indian, you're going to go to burgundy every single time. Burgundy and gold, I would hope. So with that being, you want creek water? So with that being said, I wanted just a touch of Burgundy, but my thing is I have it in me to go wild, but when it comes down to it, it's in the booth. It's time to make decisions. I always bail. Every single time I bail.
Yeah.
The way that you always throw purple in, I love it.
Yeah.
I can never commit to it. Never, ever, ever. Not until I had you paint a helmet for me and I finally...
Oh, shit. My bad.
And I finally, what did I tell you? I said, hey, I have an idea. Here's a couple of ideas. This is what I want on the back. You do you. And you're like, fuck you, dude. Tell me the colors you want. And I'm like, No, you do you. I'm sick of this. Not you, but like painting things. I'm sick of making these decisions. It's too stressful.
It is.
Not only do I do it for my own shit, but I do it for so many customers.
Yeah.
Whether it's bikes, cars, trucks. I've been doing it for so long that I am tapped out on creativity at the moment. Jace, you need to pick the colors for my helmet. I promise I will not complain.
Yeah.
And you're like, nope, you're picking a color. Finally, I told you one color. I was like, all right, go ahead and go with this teal turquoise, right? And you did. And everything else you freestyled. You didn't give me any other options. You took over. You did things differently than how I would do them.
Mm-hmm.
But I love it for exactly what it is. So when it comes to my bikes, ugh, it's the worst. If you look at my track record on my bikes, they are the cleanest paint jobs that you're going to find. They're crisp. They're on point. They flow. The flow is so important.
Yeah.
The color choices, super key. Say what you want about mustard. Still super hot.
I have mustard on my other bike, the one I just sold.
I remember.
Because yellow was always one of those colors that I never saw it. I just didn't see it in paint jobs. Mm-hmm. So back up a little bit to your point. You know, there's certain things that so my color palette that I tend to work with is kind of it's part of my brand, right?
Absolutely.
You know, because I always think like Jeremy, right? Jeremy works with such a wide variety of very, very loud colors, mm-hmm. right? And it fits him. It fits his style.
Absolutely.
Right? But if someone came to me and said, hey, man, I want to do these colors together, I'd be pulling my hair out trying to see it.
Right.
You know?
So not that red isn't a color for you, but when you came out with that blood-ass red helmet with Marilyn Monroe on it, oh, my God, dude, I wanted a red helmet now.
Yeah.
Because that seemed out of character for you.
And that customer wanted that. And sometimes it, you know, I'm not opposed to that because I've been wanting to not get away from flake because I love doing it. But as like an artist, sometimes you want to like explore, you know, how do I make solid red appeal?
Mm-hmm.
You know, other than the fact that it's bright, solid red, right? How do you make it like interesting to look at? You know what I mean? And that helmet was easy to do with that and the carbon fiber and things like that. So that was a good one. But
mm-hmm.
you know, like my last bagger, the one I've been riding, you know, that was me looking through a color book and going, what's a color no one ever uses on a bike?
Right. And you got this weird ass brown, green, honey gold.
Yeah.
Like doesn't make sense. You really can't name the color.
But it's super simple. It's galaxy gray with candy gold over it, right?
Right.
Easy.
Right.
But
it's not.
I was also thinking about it. I was thinking about this on my ride down here from Milwaukee today. You know, I was like, man, because I was thinking about this bike, what color did I paint it? Because I just want to do a solid color on it, right? For Sturgis. What color did I paint this bike? Man, like, I love looking at blues and purples, right? I love those. But I just can't rock a blue or purple bike, personally.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
not as a solid, just a solid color.
Well, just
it's too much.
I don't even know if I can do it as like a physical like paint job.
Okay, because the way you have to do it is you have to figure out what somewhat of an idea of your paint job for the future. Pick your base color for that paint job now.
See, I was thinking about that, but
then you're not wasting as much time.
That's too complicated. Around. And then you get stuck with it because I'll probably change my mind before December when I take it apart. Okay,
so with that being said, I love you, but you're an idiot for wanting to paint that motorcycle right now. Dude, I get it. It's black.
Everyone's, you called it a Me Too bike before I even got here.
I understand, but you need to just ride that wave for now because there's almost no color motorcycle.
I want
to
paint it gray and do purple wheels and call it my painter. Nobody's done that yet.
I get that, but It's so, I don't know. I guess I look at paint jobs a little more different than
you.
They're very time consuming.
They are.
It's a lot of work to paint a bike.
To paint a bike solid color, I can do it over a weekend.
It's still a lot of work.
Well, I got a helper.
I guess you're faster than I am. I don't know.
Well, if I painted a solid color, I'm not trying to make a show bike. I'm just trying to make it not black.
Okay.
But so when I was riding down here, I was like, why do I lean towards warm color bikes that I always want to put cool pinstriping colors in? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then I was thinking, like, you know, because one bike I really like right now that's super simple, but it fucking pops to me is like the one Charlie Rock built for his chick, the Sassy Pants or whatever.
Yeah.
With the turquoise wheels.
Okay.
Fucking love it, dude. Like,
what do you love about it?
I love the wheels.
Okay, so you like that it's a black bike with turquoise wheels.
Uh-huh.
And then obviously the tank emblem helps it pop a little bit. I get that. Okay.
Yeah.
So take your black ass Roglide and make the wheels a cool color and call it a fucking
call
day.
Call it a day.
And I'm saying, dude, like, I think that you need to just wait and just commit to your paint job when you're ready for it.
So what I was thinking about was like, what? You know, because Steve Chamberlain, obviously from the same area, and he painted his bike blue,
uh-huh.
and he's kind of been in that blue kick with stuff. I was like, why does it seem like people from up north like blue more than the people south, like the warm colors more?
Well, don't forget Mason Mary. Yeah. He's got a Smurf-ass blue bike. So, yeah, there's a lot of, I don't know.
It's almost like the, because it's obviously, it does, you know.
What are you saying, like, certain colors are demographic?
I'm saying that, like, maybe they're more used to cool colors because they're in an area that sees a lot more colder climate. As opposed to down south, we have a lot more warmer summer.
So your earth tones
are
going to be more brown.
And you're kind of in the middle right here with all the shit.
Am I? Well, so we have a lot of green around here. So my soft tail was green. I had a chopper that was green. I've had quite a few things that were green. A lot of people say that green motorcycles are bad luck. And I was...
You heard the story behind that?
I don't know if I've heard it.
So the reason they said that is because a lot of people used to wreck them.
Okay.
But that was because they used to make a lot of them for the military.
So there's just a ton of green motorcycles.
There's a ton of green motorcycles, okay. Yeah.
Fair enough. I never fell for that. I painted my soft tail, like Cholo style bike, like an olive pearl.
Yeah.
With orange pinstriping on it. So it was super 1930s, 40s throwback.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
But then we did mustard. So it's imitation gold pinstriping.
Yeah.
But on black with that green in there, it was
straight. That color's badass.
Yeah, it was straight mustard. And it was, that bike was so sick. And that's, to answer your question further about my style of paint, that was another one that detailed to death. It had a stock color, that olive pearl color. So guys at Cedar are like, oh, I got the same color bike. And I'm like, yeah, but look at this one.
Mm-hmm.
Like, spend a minute with it. And then they do, and they're like, holy crap, I can't believe that, you know?
Yeah.
So a lot of my stuff is, like, very, there's usually, like, some meaning to it. It's understated, but very, very detailed and perfect.
Yeah.
Until I did my Road King. The mustard bike. I finally got to the point where I'm like, I got to step out of the comfort zone. And this color looks really cool, but it's ugly as shit. And everyone will agree. And everyone said, why are you choosing that color? What the hell is wrong with you? And it became more of like a challenge. Like, all right, I'm going to see if we can make this thing look cool with this ugly ass color.
Yeah.
And I think absolutely mission accomplished. I've had numerous painters tell me that they love how it turned out, even though they hate the color.
Yeah.
So I took that, and I still love that paint job. I'm not going to change it. I'm very happy with it. I took that because I felt like I challenge accepted, challenge conquered.
Yeah.
That's not easy to do with a paint job, especially when you're doing it yourself. It's different. Springle and I did that whole paint job.
Yeah. Right?
It's different when you're handing it off to someone and saying, here, do this.
Yeah.
I'll pick it up in a month, 2 months, whatever the jail time is, right? We're forced to do this, whether we love the color or not, and we have to muster through. See what I did there? Yeah. We have to power through this, whether we love this color or not, and we did, and we killed it.
So, hear me out on why I was looking for a rare color to work with. I don't think.
Hold on, before you talk about that, look at what I did with the Challenger.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, weird ass color, not common.
Yeah.
Do you see the repetition coming off of the Road King? move into the Indian. I'm like, okay, I got an Indian. Jace hates this bike. How am I going to impress Jace? Okay. No, but really, you got to choose a color that no other Indian is ever going to be painted.
Yeah.
If you want to stand out, paint's the first thing that everyone sees, right?
Check this out. I think that there's two things at play here, right? Because we all know it's super easy to make a gold bike sick. A gold can, you know, peg in gold.
Right.
Easy, right? You can almost just paint it peg in gold and everybody's going to fucking love it, mm-hmm. right? But I noticed that, like, some of these easier color combinations, which, don't get me wrong, I do them a lot. A lot of customers want that. Like, I want this candy red and burgundy and silver and black. You're never going to go wrong with that color, right? But so many other painters use those colors for bikes. And so when you're trying to make a bike that's going to stand out in the crowd, and it's especially something where you want people to remember that and be like its own, its separate thing, like it's new trend or some shit. You know what I mean? You have to find a color or a combination that is truly unique and different, right? And you have to... I've always grown up knowing these badass painters and these other people that do amazing things. And it's always like, why didn't I think of that?
Right.
You know? And it's like, okay, well, now I'm spending the time and thinking of the most that I can. I might not think of it all. I still have that moment all the time.
Right.
Fuck, why didn't I think of that?
Right.
But I want my bike to just stand out and be its own thing and not be like, oh, that, you know, that color is the same one that's on this other bike, or it's this or it's that. It's kind of like
right. It
started the tree of that color. You know what I mean?
I totally understand and agree. And that's clearly how I make my decisions mm-hmm. based off the Indian, the Road King, my soft tail. Before I painted the Road King mustard, it was a weird... It was called Anvil. It was this grayish slate blue.
Yeah, I remember that.
With bright white and then candy ass orange. I mean, it stuck out. Pop, it was really cool. So I'm very good with that. And I listened to you talk plenty about finding these sources of inspiration, whether it be some straight gay shit.
Yeah.
Pillows, fucking fall foliage, the Leafs in September. Just... constantly paying, and we talked about, I don't know why we're talking about this again. We did this on the last podcast. We talked about women's fashion and the colors. Here we are again. It's clearly because you got a new bike and you need to get this figured out, but you have what it takes to come up with that color.
Yeah.
But it's getting tougher because now that Harley did the billiard colors.
Yeah.
You got that dope ass billiard blue. The billiard burgundy was really cool. Maybe you need to go straight cue ball. You know what I'm saying?
I've had in my lifetime, I've had lots of orange bikes mm-hmm. and I've had lots of white bikes and I've had my fair share of gold bikes.
Right.
I've only had one red bike and that was Sport Bike Days. And I had a turquoise blue Dyna that was pretty good for me.
I remember that one.
But
can you really think of a blue color that can go on a bagger that's no graphics, just
I don't
one
think
color.
It's me, though. So the difference is like...
I don't think so either.
It's not... It doesn't fit me. It doesn't fit like I want to... Every time I walk out to the bike, be like, fuck, that thing looks good. And I still feel that way about my other bike. You know what I mean?
Like... The Rogue Glide you just
sold. Yeah, the Rogue Glide I just sold. So it's like, I want that feeling. You know what I mean?
You will not feel that way about this bike.
Do you know
no
how...
No matter what color you paint it. There's so, not a color under the sun.
Probably not.
If it's solid color... It ain't gonna happen. You know that.
So the last paint job I had on it before the current one.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So I did that one. I drew it up and I sat on it for a couple months. And I usually don't do that because I have a heart. I usually change my mind. Well, as soon as I painted that bike, mm-hmm. I drew the current paint job.
Okay.
But not the colors. I drew it to use the champagne flake that I came out with House of Color. I mean,
Paint Huffer.
And the goal was to run that champagne flake with this.
Right.
And then I got a chance to work with the champagne flake, and I just didn't have enough time under the belt with that color to find my groove with it. You know what I mean? And so I was looking through a fucking, PPG, you know, Vibrance thing, and I found that the color that I have now, and I was like, fuck, man, this thing's hitting. And so I started playing with, like, what if I paint it this color and do this and do that? And a lot of it was on the fly, and that was the paint job I did in a week. So it sucks.
I remember. I told you were crazy for that, too. I think it was a couple of years ago at Sturgis, like 2 years ago, you had brought your bike, and we were at like, I don't know.
Starbucks?
Not Starbucks. I think we were at the Bell Brawl. And I talked to you, and because you had just painted the bike for Sturgis, right? The first paint job.
I painted it for the camp out that year, okay. But then I brought
Sturgis. So I had not gone to the camp out. Yeah. I hadn't had a chance to see it. I had never met you yet. So I met you, seen your bike, and you told me you were going to repaint it. And I was like, what the fuck is wrong with this dude?
Yeah.
This paint job's really cool. And you're like, yeah, you know, it's okay. But clearly you had something in mind.
Well.
So I think with that being said, you know what's right here. You know that you can't paint this bike a solid color.
Well, it's more of a, it's more of a, okay, this is the reason why I need to paint a solid color.
I know what you're
because I have a lot of responsibilities with sponsors, right? I have a lot of responsibilities to provide content for them.
You have people looking at you.
Yeah, so.
And you have to be noticed.
If, as long as it's a solid color that nobody else can buy that way.
Right.
Then it does well for pictures. And don't get me wrong, like the science behind the marketing, it's kind of gross. You know what I mean? It is, mm-hmm. But at the same time, it's like, this day and age, it's all about like your bike. You want to look badass in person. You want people to finally see it in person. Go, dude, this is as sick as I felt like it was online. Whoa. But ultimately, you need it to fucking fuck online, because online is where people see it every day while they're taking a shit, while they're laying in bed, right. While they're at work, while they're all the. That's where it's really inspiring people to make purchases. Unfortunately,
have you entertained Jeremy's secret weapon?
No, what is it?
Ball sack pearl.
Which one is that? You mean the pebble base?
It's very fleshy. It's very
pearl. Oh yeah, that's we used to do that shit back in the day. Like a rough base, then put the pearl over it that makes it look.
Yeah, but not the texture though. Just the color of it. Ball sack pearl.
Okay.
It was mostly a way for me to say the term ball sack pearl.
I feel like you just got, like, you made $20 to say ball sack pearl in the podcast or something.
If I say it again, I'm up to 60. No, it was just a nod to Jeremy because I love him. I get it. I do. I think what we probably should do is stop talking about the color choice of your stock ass bike right now.
Yeah, yeah.
And we should, and here's why. Not because I'm not interested in that. I would love.
Yeah, we could do that for all night.
My opinion, I would love it. But I think we should do it off the record.
Yeah.
Because, hey, we're all about staying ahead of the times. Mm-hmm. We're 10 steps ahead on this type of shit. We can't be giving all of our secrets out right now.
Yeah, yeah, that'll be on the Patreon.
All right. So, next subject.
What's the next one?
I don't have a clue.
We haven't, so since we did the last podcast, the last podcast, I was on my way to get the 131 motor put in, right?
Yeah, it's actually cool how this is working out.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
So you stopped on your way up on what most people would say is the coolest Road Glide you could think of.
Mm-hmm.
And holy shit, did you put some miles on that thing and then put a big motor in it.
Yeah.
Which we're going to circle back to.
Okay.
And then holy shit, where did this come from? You sold your bike. Boom. Just like that.
You know how many people were mad? Not mad at me.
I think a lot of people thought it was just a joke, and then, boom, done.
Well, people said, you're going to regret it, you're going to regret it. It's like, you know what?
You've gotten your money.
I would have, right? I've got my money worth 100%, but the thing is that it couldn't have gone to someone better.
Okay.
Well, you know what I mean?
Obviously helpful to let go of that type of bike.
It's like somebody that I think is going to appreciate it the way I did bought it. Not somebody that's looking to be insta-famous.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
The dude goes, man, I want to ride it like you did. Yeah, I'm like, fuck yeah.
Miles.
You know what I mean? And so that's to me. And then it's like, so that part, that made me excited to sell it, right? Because if.
It makes it a lot easier to let it go.
Yeah. Because you feel like they're going to enjoy it the same way. I mean, don't get me wrong. Like, I hope the dude makes it his in some form or fashion, different than the way I did.
Right.
But ultimately, you know, it means a lot to me to see, just the same way I still see my FXR10s on Homeboy's bike in Hawaii.
Yeah, the gold one.
Yeah, it's like, dude, like that right there, that shit just means so much to me when you see someone like treating your artwork.
Yeah, watching the memory live on.
Yeah.
And it's, you start to think of things as not just...
This shit is not material. It's material for a lot of people, but it's not for everybody.
Yeah. It kind of goes back to what we were talking about with my losing my cars in the fire.
Yeah.
It's like, I used to think of like, this is my baby. This is me. But, and then I don't want anyone else to have it. Right. Especially with the cars.
Yeah.
But then after that, you're like, you know what? You need to stop and realize that this car is a 1960 and it's been around for literally 50 years.
Yeah.
I'm just a stepping stone in this car's journey. Think about all the previous owners. Think about the stories this car could tell if it could speak. Yeah. Right. I'm just a caretaker at this point. And when you start viewing things like that, you think of the item is just on its journey through life. Right. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of the same thing with your motorcycle. The same thing just happened with that olive pearl softail I was just talking about that I owned. A good buddy of mine ended up buying it in Kansas City, and I was so stoked. Homie's got it. He takes such good care of everything he owns. He's going to ride it a little bit. It couldn't be better. And maybe I'll get to see it in person, and I won't be pissed about it. I'll be excited. Maybe I'll get to ride it again, that kind of thing. Well, he's been hanging out with me a little bit more lately, and we talk every day. Guess what? He wants to sell it. Well, it's a badass bike, and it sells in the first couple weeks.
Yeah.
So now I'm bummed because I don't have the money to buy it right now. I'd have loved to buy it back and just put it in the corner, but can't afford to just have a bike sitting here. So kind of cool because it's going back to South Dakota.
That's cool.
Rapid City, which is where I bought it from. So that's cool. But it's just on its journey. So it left South Dakota, came down here to get built. I rode the shit out of it.
Put the miles main thing on it. Is that you,
now it's going back.
When you build something, or, you know, like say, for instance, my Road Glide, when I customize something, that it's cool enough that people want to leave it essentially the way it is.
To not have to repaint it. And continue it on its journey, like I'm talking about, for sure. So that's what's cool about this podcast right now is the last time you're on that bike, you're going to get the motor, huge moment. You got the motor. It was you enjoyed the hell out of it. You continued to make more memories, do more trips, do another camp out. And now seeing you come through on a brand new bike, I'm like, it's just a rental bike at this point, you know? I'm like, it's weird seeing you on a solid color bike, first off.
Yeah.
You already know that. Get used to that. You're going to be sick and tired of hearing that real quick. But it's cool because I know the next time I see that bike,
it'll be a solid color.
Well,
just I'm probably clearly, not black.
I'm sure I'll see you in Sturgis in a couple weeks, and I support the bike staying black for Sturgis wholeheartedly. If it's a different color, you do you.
Okay. You do you, boo.
But I look forward to the next time I do get to see the bike in a whole different form. And that's what's really cool.
That's why I'm trying to give myself the rest of this year to work out the ideas and work out the plan and work out things because
shoot for Daytona.
Yeah. Shoot. If I shoot for Daytona, like, honestly, I'll have the FXR back on the road and that can be my
something
I can ride while I tear this one down. Mm-hmm. I still haven't decided if I'm gonna go as deep as you did on yours. Mm-hmm. But I want it to be a rider and, there's so much about my brand and me changing in this kind of time where it's not changing like I don't want to do what I've been doing. It's just like I want to evolve in a sense. Like I want to try new parts. I want to try new setups, new styles, and get a feel for it. Like, it was weird. Like, I thought I was going to absolutely suck riding a stock bike from, you know, the 400 plus miles I just did today.
Right.
And don't be wrong, it wasn't as badass as it would have been on my other bike, but I was like, this is kind of different. Like, I didn't feel like, you know, being on a bone stock ass bike, riding down roads, it's just like, I'm just riding a bike now. I'm not leading a performance bagger.
Did you like blending in?
Yeah.
You enjoyed it?
I did, yeah.
You'll enjoy it for a moment.
Right? I always tell people that. And
dude, it's exactly what happened with my Indian. I got the bike, and it's got a nice enough paint job. It's bright red.
Yeah.
Totally out of character for me. Tons of chrome on it. This is not a bike that I would ride, right? Forget the fact that it's an Indian, but just the color choices, okay? I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to leave it. I don't want to paint this bike. I just want to do minimal parts and make it as badass performance based. And what I mean by that is make it handle as good as I possibly can, get it lifted off the ground and hit the mountains on it and just enjoy it. Bulletproof daily dragger road trip bike. This is my long haul bike.
Yeah.
That's why I bought it. And I was going to leave it red. I was going to leave chrome on it. Fuck. I don't possess that gene. It does. Yeah. It does not exist.
I know what you mean.
And it doesn't exist for you either.
It every doesn't.
Thing you've ever owned. It's we're one and the same. We're not capable. It's a cop out. You know that it is saying that. So it is. You don't have what it takes to just not go to your full potential. But if you're going to do it as a business standpoint with marketing for specific parts,
yeah,
now that's almost more of a challenge to you, and that's cool. That's going to help you grow. It's going to
open look at your mind like,
to different ideas and perspectives.
I look at it like you know, a lot of different things, but basically, so my last bike was, you know, a lot of the brands that I do work with, you know, it ends up being their catalog cover bike for two of them, and then it was another one's. It was Olin's marketing thing for a little bit with some of the pictures I shot.
Yeah, the photo from Starbucks.
Yeah.
My bike was in that photo too.
Exactly. So it's like, you know, there's so many different aspects coming along. It's like sometimes, like, you know, even doing photography, it gives me a chance to get my head at, like, clear the noise of like paint, you know, idea.
Yeah, it's exhausting, dude.
You know, so it's,
you,
I don't know.
For you to sit and talk about how you're, four helmets a month is comfortable for you. I think that's insane. Like, I know four helmets isn't like a ton of work, but it's not just the spraying and the taping and the striping. It's, or the sanding. It's every second that goes into a helmet.
Yeah.
It's exhausting. I know what it takes. It's not easy, dude. And to keep digging and deeper and trying to stay fresh and relevant and different, that's exhausting. So,
yeah.
That's why I don't understand why you'd want to spray your bike a different solid color. I really feel like you're wasting your time. If you think it's just for photo ops, man, nobody takes photos of solid color bikes, regardless.
Mark's bike is solid color.
Mark's bike has an inverted fucking front end on it.
Oh, it does?
Come on, bro. It's got an $8,000 swing arm on it.
I bet you I can take I can paint my bike a solid color and get more likes on it.
Ooh, gray. Hey, maybe
I'll paint it CVO gray.
Your My Painter plan might work out then.
Yeah, exactly.
So, gray, purple wheels.
Look, I get it. There's plenty of angles that may not make sense, but
we almost have to be very strategic though. Like, you don't have a lot of time to.
Yeah, backtrack. I don't. That's why I just. I mean, at the same time, if it's a badass color, the good thing about doing these bikes is that these parts are all interchangeable. If somebody else likes it, I don't have to repaint this bike. I can just easily trade somebody's tins.
Yeah, I understand.
And it stays on the road.
I felt the same way with that Road King that I did over the winter. And it was a 2020, not a scratch on it, no miles on it, River Rock Denim Gray.
Yeah.
Really cool.
Oh, that's a pretty color. Yeah, I like it.
Like, man, I'm not using any of these tins. None of them. Full carbon body, knee pockets in the tank. I don't need none of this shit. Hell yeah. I'm going to sell this entire paint set. Someone's going to pay $2,000 for this all day.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck. All of it is sitting in that room back there. The only thing I've sold off that is two lids. And I only sold two lids because this chick needed one lid because she scratched hers and had the same color bike. Mm-hmm. And it was cheaper to buy a lid than it was to repaint a lid and possibly not have it match, especially because it's denim.
Yeah.
And I refused to sell her one lid.
Yeah.
I said, if you're buying a lid, you're fucking buying two lids. You're not just buying one.
So the difference is that's a stock color.
Okay, true. Okay, so good point.
If you have a color that, like I said, the one thing I'm definitely going to do is it's not going to be a color you can buy.
Yeah.
So no matter what, it's like a solid color. Let's just be real. If someone wants to do a solid color bagger Road Glide, I know my prices. Like, you're not getting that for less than $3,500, sure. And that's, you know, depending on what color it is. To be honest with you,
but it needs to have like metallic pearl
something. I'm not gonna flake it out because to me, a flaked out solid color bike is just a little bit too loud for me.
It's too much.
Yeah. But like a nice clean color that contrast well with black. I haven't really decided which route I'm going with any of the kind of colors on the bike.
Sure.
So I'm probably just going to keep everything black for now and then see where it goes. But
will you swap the wheels on this one too?
Because I don't like those wheels at all.
Okay.
I don't like the those rotors that come on that on the front wheel.
Yeah, but the wheel itself, if you were to put cool rotors,
I mean,
on it,
yeah, I don't like on. The I don't like the wheels either. Okay. I prefer the last year the 19s,
the Talon wheels. Really? Okay.
I thought even though
really finally nailed it with a decent
they don't look bad. Don't get me wrong, they don't look bad, but yeah. These are probably way easier to clean than Talon wheels. The Talon wheels were fucking nightmares.
Yeah, real thin.
But wheel wise, like I'll probably end up going with Jade Affiliate again. Okay. I've been doing some work with Arlen Ness. I'm not. Mm-hmm. I really want to try some new shit on
great
this bike.
Great guys, at yeah. Ness, dude. I mean, those dudes have taken such good care of me on some of these builds I've been doing.
Mm-hmm.
They market it well. They take care of me on pricing. They're amazing people just in general.
And they ride bikes.
Dude, they ride bikes. They're awesome guys. I mean, I cannot say enough about these dudes. Mm-hmm. And there's never been a time in my life where I've said anything negative about Arlen Ness. Not as a man, as a motorcycle guy, but the brand.
The brand, yeah.
But it was never parts I would run on my bike. It was always too mainstream. You know
yeah.
what I'm saying? But more recently here, they have put some really dope parts out, and their anodizing holds up really well. It's bright. It's bold. But once you finally pull the trigger, you have it in your hand, you own it, you're running it, whatever. It's such high-quality stuff, man.
Yeah.
It fits perfect. There's zero headaches. Highly recommend that stuff. And awesome crew to work with.
So. I mean, let's play out this scenario, right? You mm-hmm. have that build. You got another Challenger build coming. I don't know if you're able to talk about it.
I can talk a little bit. It's a
so,
good possibility.
So, I mean, where this shit is right now in performance baggers, like the bikes that have been built that are on the road, the bars that have been set, like, not saying what do we do next, but do you still feel like there's a lot left untouched in this?
Mm-hmm.
Without getting
not really
over the top?
No, like I'm starting to sort of become numb to it.
That's kind of what I was getting at when I was saying like riding the stock bike was like, it's nice not having to feel like, oh, this is
refreshing a little bit.
Yeah.
I think to me it's now that we're seeing so many baggers with T-bars and step up seats and reservoir shocks and all that, it's no longer exciting because there's so many clearly.
Yeah.
I mean, you get excited because you're like, oh, fuck yeah, you too, hell yeah. But what keeps it very exciting is you and I coming from a somewhat of a similar background where I wasn't stacking a ton of miles on bikes like you were.
Mm-hmm.
I was building a lot of bikes. I was riding bikes, but I wasn't doing a lot of traveling.
Yeah.
I wasn't getting out to the state parks. I wasn't building these friendships and bonds with people traveling, right? So building these style of bikes is really what put me over with wanting to ride as much as possible because these bikes are just completely unlimited to what they can do.
Yeah.
They will do anything you throw at it with a smile on their face, and they're just fantastic once you set them up that way.
Yeah.
So now that I'm seeing more and more of it, it completely changed me as a rider, as just like a hobby versus a lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
Still not going to call myself a biker, but a hobby versus a lifestyle. And then, like knowing how it converted me, I know that when you set your bike up the way we're setting it up, I know that if anyone else does it, it's going to convert them too. There's no way it won't, because we've all had some experience with air ride. We've all had some experience with stretched this or tall bars this or too big of a wheel that, whatever the case is, some dumb shit that you threw too much money at one or multiple products that made your bike less useful.
Yeah.
Right? Now that we have seen the benefits of spending your money on things that do nothing but make your bike so much better, there is no coming back from that. How do we change that? We won't. It's just going to want us riding more and more and more.
Yeah.
It's going to lead to people like Larry buying a fucking Pan America.
I'm still not okay with that.
It's going to lead to a good buddy of mine here in St. Louis, big time 1% club guy, just bought a Pan America.
Yeah.
Last dude I'd ever expect. But the dude, right, he fucking stacks miles.
So do you think that the performance bagger and ultimately the performance trend as a whole
mm-hmm.
has pretty much reinvigorated people to ride?
I think, yeah. Well,
ride
custom bikes. Yes.
Yeah.
Not that they're over the top, cut in half, welded neck custom.
Yeah.
But bikes with a lot of money, or how about this? Even better, a bike with a bitchin' $10,000-$15,000 paint job on it.
Yeah.
My bike, your bike, so many others. Although I got this killer paint job, it doesn't mean it's just going to sit in the corner and get wiped down all day.
Yeah.
I built it to ride it. And every rock chip does hurt my soul, no doubt about it. But it's part of it. It's you're earning those scars. And it's different when you put the, for you and I, it's different when you put the actual blood, sweat, and tears into that paint job yourself.
Yeah.
It hurts worse that way. Even though it's easier for us to fix it, it's different than the guy that just sends it out, has it painted, and now rides his motorcycle.
Yeah.
Because he didn't do the time. The money's different than the time. It's the effort, right?
Yeah.
So it does suck seeing them get used and abused. Like you were talking about selling your old bike, and it just felt a little older, a little looser, a little more broken in, mm-hmm. versus this new bike. That's the whole thing about it. It's like, we're paying, it's not that we're like necessarily buying our way into something, but we're paying to do what we want to do on these bikes.
Yeah.
And it's making huge waves, and now it's led to all the races. I watched a race in here on my TV yesterday. It was so sick watching it in here. It's led to, what are we at? Like 4 races now, 2 different leagues, the rivalries, the parts production that's coming from it. It's blowing up. One of my best buddies, Chris, KZ Eliminator, Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking dude's taking his brown ass Kama Sutra Road Glide, gorgeous bike, taking it and putting it on a track this weekend.
Nice.
And I'm like, dude.
I saw him like making some posts about that in one of our chats.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He found a suit.
Yeah. I saw him with the suit. That's what it was.
He found a suit. He found some boots. He is doing what he's got to do to the bike to get it on a track safely.
Yeah, past.
And dude, he's going to race his fucking bike. It's the only bike he owns. It's a gorgeous, perfect bike. And I'm like, Chris, what are you going to do if you fucking put that thing into the wall?
Yeah.
You know? And he's like, well, hopefully I don't. And I'm like, oh my God, dude. Like, we're now to that point where we're going to see.
So I wonder though, with that being said, because, you know, I think that not everybody gets to do the miles like I have and Steve has and some mm-hmm. other people, right? Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people kind of want to, but, you know, just can't.
Well, you have to set your life up to be able to do that. Absolutely.
So I wonder if the racing thing is going to be the new alternative, because you can do that over a weekend. Maybe people are like, oh, well, I can't do the miles or make the campouts or do the trips and be with everybody, but I can do the track this weekend, and that becomes the new circle.
It's a bittersweet thing. It's not like seeing like the performance bagger blowing up and becoming more mainstream. Like, that's a bittersweet thing.
Yeah.
We would both agree on. The racing thing, not that I'm a racer, it's a bittersweet thing to me too, because I think that so many of us are fully capable at riding in a very aggressive, fast, fun type of way, manner, but we have zero track experience. And I think you get enough of dipshits out there that think they're badass and get out on a track and total their bikes, hurt themselves, hurt others. I actually don't condone that at all. Like,
yeah.
I know that's what the practice days are for, and I get that. I'm open for the progression. I think that's great, but I actually view it more as a sketchy fucking mess, man. Like, I love it.
A lot of the brands feel the same way. They're, you know, one of the, I wouldn't say rivalries, but one of the issues between both promoters is, one, the cost of entry is higher and it's more geared towards people that have put more money into their shit, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
They want to keep less inexperienced riders off the track with the professionals, which I understand. But then, you know, the devil's advocate, I love seeing Steve Chamberlain out there, you know.
Yeah.
Like I said, there was so many homies at the Bagger Race League event that was it was just more awesome just to see all these dudes out there that I've ridden with or hung out with or camped with or partied with or done podcasts with. You know what I'm saying?
That was absolutely the best part of it. But I think that the companies are correct on that, with getting the way that BRL split up those classes like that. to have the GP class and then the pro class,
yeah,
or the pro stock, it honestly was perfect. To have some average dudes, like, I don't mean to put, I don't mean to say Tony Tucker's average, okay? But to have some average dudes, because Tony rips on a, on,
yeah, he did flat, fucking on phenomenal.
Flat dude, but on flat track sporties and yeah, hooligan. To have some average dudes that are not famous pro riders or expert riders, whatever, and lump them all on the same class like that was awesome.
Smart, yeah.
Yeah, it was awesome. Now, good example, Zach Nation. He was, I watched him yesterday on Moto America,
mm-hmm,
in the GP class with Tyler O'Hara and Kyle Wyman. And Zach is an amazing rider. It shows that he's not as advanced as what the dudes that are winning are. But to see him being able to run in the same classes in different leagues is really cool to see. You know what I'm saying? It's like you can have a guy that he can keep, he's not winning the GP class. He can make it around the track and keep up with them, right? But then in this other league, he could probably be winning these races because he's leaps and bounds ahead of other average types of riders. So I think that's really cool.
I think at the end of the day, like, this is, you know, a lot of people's first race was the BRL. So for the most part, I think that, you know, let's just chalk up 2021 as a practice year for everybody. I'll be super stoked to see what Tony Tucker does next year. I'll be super stoked to see what Steve Chamberlain and everybody does next year after they've had a couple more track days under their belt.
Do you ever get the chance to ride with Rusty, Black Charlotte?
No, but
ride with him.
I've heard enough to know that he's a bad motherfucker.
This motherfucker is a nut job.
Yeah.
Straight up. I've seen this dude pass me doing 90 on a curve, 90 mile an hour sweeper. He'll pass me in the left lane. He'll look backwards on the sweeper and drag one hand on the ground and wave at me like, see ya. And I'm like, dude, how is this dude so good? He's setting his roguelite up. Well, okay, first off, fuck you, Rusty. You have a Rogue King, not a roguelite. Yeah. You have a fake-ass roguelite. You broke. We had a Three Amigo thing with Marshall Tucker with the Rogue Kings and the Road Warrior fairings, and he left us, so I'm still bitter about that.
Yeah, yeah.
I do love him. But he took his Rogue King, made a roguelite, turned into a wheelie bike. He's awesome at wheelies. He's a great stunt rider. Watch his progression doing stunt riding. Super cool.
Yeah.
But he used to race sport bikes on tracks.
Yeah.
He was pretty good. He is now setting his roguelite up for the track. And this motherfucker is going to be something to worry about, dude. He's fast as shit. I've watched him and I've taken off with him and Steve Chamberlain on in the Smokies.
Yeah.
I'm right behind the two of them. And I'm going to tell you, I kept up with those dudes for like 2 or 3 minutes. And after that, those dudes are gone.
How long do you think before an average meetup around town with performance baggers is going to turn into, hey man, do you see the racers are going to be the new most popular thing? And I'm not saying that like I'm hating
like,
on
like it. Versus stunt riders.
No. Like just in general, like it you know how people are, right? And I'm a dance around a whiskey thought right now.
All
right,
because that's some.
I'm not trying to talk shit about anything, but just people in general that are looking for a clan to be a part of will tend to jump onto whatever's the most popular thing, and whether it's the stunt riders, whether it's the bagger racing guys, or whether it's, you know, certain guys in our circle or our world of performance baggers that make a name for themselves, right? Oh, so-and-so is going to be there. You know, like, dude, you know how many people like knew about Steve Chamberlain before Steve Chamberlain ever even was in their area just because of all the different social channels and things like that? And so there's all these things. So I wonder, because I still think that, like, while racing is wholeheartedly going to help improve parts and make the things that we get to put on our bikes better, I still think that people jumping on a bike and traveling on them and showing that they actually work longevity-wise is still more valuable.
I agree completely.
Because most people aren't going to put their bike on a track. Most people want to ride it, and they want it to perform absolutely.
The fact that Steve Chamberlain has 60,000 miles on that bike,
yeah,
clapped the fuck out, deer hair still stuck in the fairing, I've been watching him almost from day one.
Yeah.
Almost from 0 miles on that bike. Pretty damn close. And to watch the journey of that bike, and I've been with him for many of those miles, as have you.
Mm-hmm.
To watch him put that thing on a track and watch it hold up and finish a race and not be in fucking dead last place. Like,
yeah.
Holding his own. Dude was damn near like fifth place. He was right there. I mean, dude, that's awesome.
To me,
that
like,
is so impressive.
The when we talk about things being sentimental, like I look at his bike. Mm-hmm. To me, it's not even mine, and I feel like it's sentimental towards our scene.
Well, it has a journey. It's been on a journey.
It's on a journey, like you were saying,
right?
And it's almost like
it has a story to tell, and there's been so many. I mean, you look at how lucky that dude is to be alive after hitting that deer mm-hmm. in the first place.
Getting
right back on
in 20 years, right? 20 mm-hmm. years, 40 years, 10 years, 5 years, whatever. When we look back on, like, I think we're getting into the sketchy waters territory with talking about performance baggers. But when you look back at this scene, right, that bike is part of what helped make this scene what it is.
Wholeheartedly, it's not just because he's my homie and I'm passionate yeah. about this stuff, but wholeheartedly, from a conscious mind, like who's open to other ideas, you couldn't be more correct about yeah. that. And on the record, I don't care what you say or think about me, performance baggers, listen, dude, if they've been around since 06 or 03 or whatever because they had apes and they went super fast, those bikes weren't on a fucking racetrack doing what these bikes are doing right now.
Yeah.
This is what it's all about. This is not drag racing. It has never fucking been drag racing.
Yeah.
So, with that being said, I'm not going to go off on a rant, but how we changed the term performance bagger to performance touring, and I don't mean we changed it. What I mean is we started using a different term, right? Yeah. Performance touring. I have done that as well, because I do agree with it too. It's about enjoying the ride, but enjoying it in a much faster, more aggressive, different way than what your average motorcycle enthusiast is doing.
Yeah.
Right? On a specific style of motorcycle that is capable of doing it
yeah.
that much quicker and that much safer.
And it's not to say, like, you know, when we did the podcast with Steve after the race, he was referring to a guy that came out there with ape hangers and totally ripped.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Never said that wasn't possible, you know, when we had all these performance bagger talks. I've always strictly been like, look, it's a style.
Right.
It's a style of bike, just mm-hmm. like every other style of bike there is. You know what I mean?
But it's a style that comes with benefits.
It does.
Where any other style
of benefits.
Any other style comes with nothing. It comes yeah. with fucking heartache and troubles and money flushed down the toilet.
Yeah.
Unless all you care about is sitting in a parking lot collecting trophies. That's it. End of yeah. story. I've been there. I've done it. Just like you have. Mm-hmm. You're not telling me shit. Like
the reason the guys like
these bikes across the country.
You know? Like I try to keep the B-Rabbit attitude with everything I do, and I only talk about shit on this podcast confidently because yeah. I've been a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or if you know, like I try to keep opinions about things that I've never experienced off the podcast from my mouth. Right.
Yep.
So when people were, you know, like I've. My life has been motorcycles since 05, 04, right? So I have had my hands in a lot of different parts of the industry and scenes over the years. And mm-hmm. I've seen the good things about certain ones and the bad things. And it's all led me down the path of feeling the way I feel about this one right now, that I, as well as everybody else, had a lot more involvement in helping it grow. Not starting it,
right?
Helping it grow,
right?
Right.
I agree. I mean,
dude, I'm on record since 08 talking about this shit when everybody was still doing other things, right? Not saying that was the early. I'm just saying, like, I'm so proud to see where it's come, and it's so awesome seeing dudes, you know, kind of accepting, you know, T-bars as their Lord and Savior to kind of get there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just trying it out, because so many people. When we first started doing road glides with T-bars and shit, people hated it.
Right.
They almost wanted to do everything else but T-bars, right? And now it's like, okay, well, you're almost there, bud, yeah. you know? And still people hate me for saying, like, you know. But it's like, why does my opinion matter that much?
I mean, it obviously does if people are taking it that wholeheartedly. I'm not going to say.
Yeah, it's like,
here.
Dude, it's your bike, man. Do you. Like, there's yeah. There's nothing saying that, like when Craig rode up to our camp out, he had ape hangers on his bike. And I love that dude the same way. If he still had ape hangers, I wouldn't give two fucks.
Right.
Right? the thing that people need to grow a pair in the motorcycle scene is you need to grow a pair of fucking balls and thicker skin. You're right. Hanging out with men who talk shit to each other.
Right.
And if you can't talk shit or you can't take shit, stay your fucking sissy ass at home.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, it's no different than any scene or any trend. Not a trend, but just coming from a car guy perspective, truck guy, motorcycle guy, it really is always going to boil down to the person. It's all about the person. I mean, I'm, you know, the car club that I'm still a part of, people always ask, it's a kind of a prestige club.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to get into that club. That's what I aspire to be in. You got to have some really badass vehicles to get into that club. And there's a high caliber there. So whenever I ran my own chapter of that club for a long time, many years. And so people would inquire, hey, how do I join your club? I just want to be part of, you know, hang out and be a part of your club and all that. I would always tell people it's 90% the person and the personality and 10% the vehicle. Mm-hmm. Okay. If you're that rare breed that fits the 90% of the person, you're automatically going to have that 10% of the vehicle because you're a rare motherfucker.
Yeah.
It's the same thing with what we're doing until it starts to become mainstream. See what I'm saying? And with that being said, like,
so that's kind of what's happening. Is it becoming mainstream?
Absolutely. Yeah. With that being said, like, I have been doing this performance touring bagger thing since like 17. So it's not longer than other people, but I've ridden big wheel bagger. I've never owned a big wheel bagger, but I've ridden big wheel baggers, choppers, drag bars, ape hangers, fucking you name it. I've been on it. I've traveled on, I've ridden. Nothing made sense besides what I've currently landed on.
Mm-hmm.
That's what works for me. So I'm just an enthusiast. I'm someone with a passion for cool shit who then turned the cool shit into actually using the cool shit, traveling the country on it, making those friendships. The whole point of that is it doesn't matter what, like you said, Craig could still be on his stock Ultra with ape hangers.
Yeah.
Dude's amazing. He's so much fun. He's down to earth. He'll give you the shirt off of his back. You want Craig around.
Yeah.
I don't care what Craig rides, but he does have a bike with T-bars on it.
Well, what happens is those guys.
He can ride. He can get, gets down. He's a badass rider. But I've ridden, you and I have both ridden with those guys that are not on bikes like ours. They're on stock ass bikes with ape hangers or whatever that can keep up with us still.
Yeah.
Right? Your bike doesn't have to look like mine for us to ride and enjoy it with each other.
Yeah.
You just need to ride the way I'm going to ride because I'm not sitting around waiting for you.
Yeah.
It's that mindset.
I don't want to wait on you because your air ride blew up.
It's like Steve says, keep the fuck up. It's that mindset.
Yeah.
It's absolutely that mindset. So unfortunately, what comes with that is T-bars and, you know,
what happens is a lot of people, like, if you hang out in a group, people say, I'm the outlier. I'm the guy that does. I don't follow anybody. It's like, bullshit. We all follow something. Sure. You know what I mean? We're all inspired by. Let's just not say follow. We're all inspired by people, friends, people we hang out with. I don't care fuck who you are. You can hate the new Tahoe and your boy buys one and you see it every day and all of a sudden you start to, starting to grow on me.
Yeah.
It's what happens when you see something a lot. Yeah. You start to see it in angles that you don't see online. You know, when you're riding next to your buddy on his T-barred out bagger, you start to look at it and go, fuck, man, dude looks kind of cool over there. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
That's just how it works. I think too many grown men are too scared to say that they're inspired by other men.
Absolutely. You know? It's a macho thing. And I don't know. I mean, I have my sources of inspiration.
Yeah.
It's not always just people. I would say there's people I'm inspired by, no doubt, but nothing to where I'm copying people. What we're getting now is a lot of copying, right? And that comes with anything and any trend and any field of anything. So it's just to be expected. And the difference here is we're grown enough now and we enjoy this so much that we know that we need to just take it as a grain of salt rather than get all pissy, throw a drama fest, do the Instagram blowing people up. Don't get me started on the motherfucker that we're thinking of right now. Cause I'm not doing it.
I'm not talking about that
experience with him too. That's it.
I've had, I've had my current bagger paint job knocked off this year.
Right.
And I had the soft tail that I did for Garley's Garage that we took to SEMA. Mm-hmm. I had that one knocked off to the T.
To the
point where I was like, homeboy did a good ass job.
Nice. Hey, well.
But see, it blew my mind.
Imitation is the most sincerest form of flattery.
As far as the soft tail is concerned, I didn't understand how the guy was that talented and would allow himself to copy something that blatantly.
Usually, have enough respect to not get to that level.
You wouldn't want to, because it shouldn't, you know, when you have a certain level of skill,
it's not
about money, it's about your legacy as who you are. And if you've put time in to have that skill, then, so my thing with that guy was like, first off, the owner called me of the bike, said, look, I had no idea this guy. I was like, look, I don't care. I literally don't care.
Yeah.
But I was like, I do wonder, you know, like, why wouldn't he specifically, because he did such a good job copying mine, as far as like not copying the lines, but just the paint job was good. It was quality shit.
Right.
You're capable of doing anything. So, you know, you should be able to look at mine and find inspiration and redo it to your standards.
Right.
Now, usually when people copy my work, it's not as good. Right. So there I'm like, okay, I've been there. I've done that. I was that guy one time. Right. You know what I mean?
Yep.
And so I'm like, okay, yeah, you're looking for inspiration. You're trying to get my work inspired you. You're trying to create it. Cool. I have no problem with that. You know, because Daniel reposts paint jobs every once in a while. And I'm like, you see it, right? You see it?
But in all fairness, even though you should be upset about it.
But at the same time, there's nothing you can do. Like that. There's...
Like straight when you're ripping someone off, though.
Yeah, when you're trying to inspire people or you're trying to be an ambassador for this industry, that comes with it. It comes with it. And you have to be ready for it. And you have to know how to, you can't be everybody's dad and you can't be a policeman to everything, right?
I get that, but you still got to put your spin on it. You still got to change.
True.
Like, I'm going to do the same paint job, but let's at least switch all these colors. Yeah. At least do that. And I know exactly what you're talking about. I've had it happen with numerous cars, lots of the mini truck stuff. What's funny... And here, this is funny. I'm going to sound like a hypocrite. Happened a lot to me and also Springle and I as a team, as a whole, on mini trucks that we've painted. Trucks that went to SEMA, lots of exposure, covers of magazines, that kind of shit. The Japanese dudes. Now, you know, and you'll probably agree, that Japanese dudes fucking more passionate than anyone.
Mm-hmm.
And they're way more talented than all of us.
Yeah, 100%. Okay?
But they look to us for the inspiration every single time, okay? So we've had numerous trucks where it was picture-perfect copied paint jobs because they think they're going to get away with it because they're in Japan. Even though the internet exists, we've seen numerous of those.
Yeah.
But they're doing a great job of it. So we're like, what the fuck? But, that's kind of cool. Yeah. At least it looks good, like you said. That soft tail you're talking about, at least he did a good job of it, right? Yeah. But I still don't take kindly to that. I just don't. Like, dude, I work so hard to stay fresh.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's what... I hate to use the term relevant, but like fresh, different, new, unique. I take a lot of pride in that.
That's what happens after you put thousands of hours into your craft, is that you get to that point where you do... have a level of creativity that some people don't have, right? And so that's the thing that like, you know, that's the unsung hero of what we do, is that nobody ever sees the amount of mental capacity that gets spent, or whatever the word would be, gets spent on figuring out or finding the inspirations or the ideas or all this shit before that ever it ever becomes a paint job or a bike build or a color combination or a fabricated part. You know what I mean? There's so much time, right? So that's where, at the end of the day, like, you know, in the paint world, people always get hung up about people copying. But in the same sense, and the reason, so when I did my Gold FXR, right, a lot of people said that I copied the unknown one, right?
Mm.
Why? Because it's a Gold FXR full fairing. Mine wasn't the first. Neither was theirs.
Maybe that's what they're claiming, is his was the first.
But there was others.
Gotcha.
So it's like, it's just a gold bike. It's not the same graphics.
Right.
Not even close.
Yeah.
And so what gets me, what I hate about the paint world when it comes to people is people say because the bike is similarly the same color, as if there's 4 million different colors of candy out there. There's not.
Right.
That because this one is the same color that I automatically copied you. Like, Pagan Gold is the most common candy gold there is.
Sure.
And no matter what you paint, like, technically that soft tail I was just referencing has the same color scheme as the my FXR. And
it was gold and black, wasn't it?
Yeah, gold, black, and gray. Yeah. Guess what mine was? Gold, black, and gray. Guess what was not on unknowns?
Yeah.
Black or gray. It was gold and brown.
Yeah, I understand. I mean, I guess it's just that...
So that's why whenever I did my bagger now, I made sure to use colors that nobody else did.
Yeah,
That I didn't have to deal with people saying that I copied somebody.
I guess it's just the exposure thing. When you're in the limelight like that, a lot of people are paying attention and... With all the positive, there's going to be some negative.
You know how hard it was to do Mark's fucking bagger? I mean, his Adina, and he wanted the same color that everybody was using?
Yeah. But I'll tell you what, like, aside from the fact that you painted another gray bike.
Yeah.
That bike does absolutely stand out in a crowd.
Exactly. You have to find the layout, way to do it.
Yeah, the layout and the spun leaf. And, I mean, you did the damn thing.
There was already a gold leaf gray battleship gray Dyna or FXR out there. I want to say Ogre painted one, but I think he's had silver leaf. I don't know, but there's plenty of them, right? Sure. So, I mean, at some points, like, that was the first real project I ever did for Mark, right?
Yep.
I think. But at some times, like, you're at the customer's mercy where you kind of have to do. I didn't have the relationship I have with him now to where I could just call him gay.
Right. Right. Yeah, do what they want.
Yeah, I'm like, all right, so let me deal. I got to deal with his ideas. Which, don't get me wrong, like, his bike is still, when I post a picture of it, it automatically goes to the top of, like, most liked pictures that I have.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, it just fucks.
Yep. Well, that's kind of the whole point of what we're doing with that good old Road Glide out there. Mm-hmm. Just trying to take it to the next level and just push the envelope. It's a very humbling thing because with my move to the new shop, I'm not going to sit here and say, like, recent success, but with really putting myself out there and riding the bikes and getting the exposure, taking the bikes places, people are noticing that I have something a little different to bring to the table.
Yeah.
And that's all I need in this world. You know, that's what I live for. It's just building to the best of my ability to show people that I have a little bit of a different take on things mm-hmm. than what the rest of the crowd does. I've never blended in ever mm-hmm. with any scene ever. So it's a humbling experience for someone to handpick you to say, you're the guy that needs to be doing this. And
well, your decision to do the Challenger was very, very smart, in my opinion, because it was a new bike.
Mm-hmm.
There hadn't been a lot of renditions of it.
Right.
And you, even though, like, Barnstorm came out with a really sick-ass one,
mm-hmm.
you still found a way to add your own touches to it to make it, not to say better or worse or whatever, but you did your own thing to it, so it was, like, it's different.
Yeah, so you know? I just seen what Carrie Hart chose to do and what Barnstorm chose to do
mm-hmm.
and said, well, I know exactly what not to do, and here I go. Watch me go. The unfortunate part with the Challenger thing is there's
not a lot of parts.
There's no parts. I mean, there's just not. And the parts that are out there, they're just not cool. You know, mm-hmm. the only parts that are worth buying at this point are the Barnstorm parts. Jake does a great job of his stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And the parts that I myself and Bare Knuckle Paul have produced together as a team.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. Like, nobody else has shit for those bikes. We're the only dudes that are doing purposely built, good-looking parts to lift your bike up, get your hands where you need them, have it as comfy as possible,
mm-hmm.
push the bike to its limits. There's, like, that's it, and still. So that's the most challenging part about that bike right now, but...
But there's still plenty of a canvas to show, you know, the paint, the...
That's the shit side of it, though, is you take what we did on that bike is... Springle and I had an idea for it. I knew what color I wanted. Springle was down, and then Poland hit me up, and he's like, hey, I really want to paint your bike. And I'm like, man, I really want you to as well, but,
yeah,
you know, I can't afford you, and how the fuck are we going to do this? Like, you're booked for like a year out, you know? I'm ready to paint this thing like in 3 weeks. So him and I came to an agreement. We figured shit out. We made it happen. It turned out fantastic. I love it. Without that paint job, what would that bike be right now? It's a cool bike. The build's cool. It's lifted up. The stance is great. The wheels, the bars. There's a lot of little subtle touches cut, changed to make the, to make what, forget whether you think it's attractive or ugly in stock form, to take and knock as much of the ugliness off as you can and make it look as bitchin' as possible. Without that paint job, what do you do? I mean, there's other bikes out there that are solid color that are kind of built right now, and they just don't jump at you.
Well, I mean, so, at the same time, I mean, maybe it's safe to say sometimes that, that you know, paint jobs are needed to kind of get the attention. Yeah, we had to
paint that bike, for sure.
You know?
Like, we had to.
You know, there's certain things in the world that, that a solid color paint job is fitting for, right?
Yeah.
A car or truck with phenomenal fab work, a bike with phenomenal fab work. But these bikes that we ride right now, the, this style of bike.
Yeah, there's not a lot of stuff you can really fab and flow and all that shit.
It, you know, kinda it kind of, you know, the paint is really, you know, in my opinion, what sets a lot of things apart. And don't get me wrong, like, I still feel like paint wise on the performance bagger, no matter what platform it is, I still feel like we're young. I feel like we haven't found. I think that some of us have started to found a niche in styling, but it's still, I think that there could be better flow from everybody on everything, you know?
Yeah, it's still, you're right, it's still young and people are, but it depends on how talented these people. But
we're also, I think we're trying new lines. I mean, your lines on that bike go different. My lines on my bagger went different.
Right.
Jeremy's on his, I think that we've all got stuck with that screaming eagle fucking two-tone that goes front to back. Right. And it's almost like trying to two-tone a car in the middle going over the hood and or through
a door handle.
Yeah.
Down the side of it. Yeah. Absolutely, dude. I have my take. That motherfucker, if you're going to ride it fast, it needs to look fast. Mm-hmm. And if it's going to look fast, it better look fast. So make it look fast sitting still. That's number one priority for any paint job that I do.
Mm-hmm.
Fast is uphill. I mean, it's flowing fast. So both of my bikes look that way. I have no clue what my next paint job will be right now. I have zero clue whatsoever. But I do know that I have what it takes to keep pulling it off. But right now, I'm just so focused. I can't even focus on my bikes anymore. Like, I just have to focus on my future, which is, you know, getting this place completely operational and customer stuff and family stuff and just the ultimate goal of just happiness at the end of the day. So I'm not stepping back by any means, but I'm kind of taking a little bit of a step back and saying, I've already proved my point. I built this Road King. I built this Challenger. I'm going to ride the shit out of them and just keep enjoying them.
Yeah.
There's nothing on my like agenda to buy, really.
Yeah.
I thought maybe along the lines of like an enduro bike, not a Pan America, but like a BMW or something.
New Road Glides come out in 23.
Right. And so I'm not against another Harley. Not at all.
Well, a new touring.
Yeah.
Touring bikes come out.
Right. And if they change it enough to make it worthy, I'll entertain it. But until then, fuck, it's just not going to happen. Not after the Challenger. Which we need to dive into.
Okay, well, let's talk about it.
Round two. Okay. We raced at the camp out. Did you beat me? What? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. If you did and so beat me, how much did you beat me by? Feet, bike lengths, let's hear it. Be honest with me.
It wasn't like a huge... Let's paint the picture, right?
I'm all ears.
So at the camp out.
I've been waiting for this.
At the camp out. We did a roll, right? We didn't do it from dead stop.
Well, I would like to, clearly I elaborate I can't a remember. Little bit too much. We did a roll because Jace said, let's do a roll. Let's start around 10 mile an hour. Maybe like first clicking into second. Let's do a roll. All right, cool. Let's do a roll. I'm in. That was your choice.
Yeah.
I'm fine with that. I'm not, that has nothing to do with this. Yeah. I just want to get that on record. We need to be very clear. We have a lot of people need to know, that want to know.
Well, okay, I feel like I'm going to offend you with whatever I say, but here, this is what I feel, okay? So
we need to be straight with each other.
This is where I think we fucked up, because for the crowd to see, the finish line that we deemed
should have been where the crowd was.
Yeah, okay. But the problem is, if we would have kept racing it there, we would have been very fast, and then we had a corner.
Yeah, we're dead.
Yep. Right? Okay. And so that probably wasn't the best idea to do. So where we were going to race to, sit down, Steve, walk down there with the camera. Mm-hmm. It was like a sign in the road kind of thing. It was an easy marker, but it was kind
for
of...
For the finish line?
Yeah.
Yeah, you blatantly pointed out, hey, that sign right there, that's our finish.
Yeah, and I think that we got up to third gear. At least we were in third gear somewhere, because I know it was a longer gear that we were on. I
feel like and we were probably over third gear.
I don't remember if it was like if I don't remember the beginning of the race at all. I don't remember if like,
because you were nervous.
Yeah, dude, fucking shitting bricks, dude. Like,
okay. All right, now that we got that out of the way,
were you not nervous?
Not at all.
Come on,
I was so fucking excited.
I was nervous
to shut you down. And in my mind, I absolutely, almost completely shut you down. And I'm so happy about it.
The thing is, all right, so.
Okay, continue.
We hit, you know, I did get you at the line, or at the thing. Okay. And don't get me wrong, I still,
at the finish line,
I was ahead, right?
Yes, absolutely.
So
I agree. Let's go on record. You were ahead of me at the finish line.
But I let off as soon as we hit the finish line.
Okay.
And then...
Do you think I didn't let off at the finish line?
I don't know.
Okay.
Because I know you passed me, and then everybody at the top thought that you beat me.
I can see that as a gray area for sure.
So I let off after the finish line.
Okay. And I could see me holding on to it.
Yeah.
So I probably continued.
Because, like I said, at that point, like, my bike didn't... So let's back up. When I raced Larry, right? Larry's got the, you know...
The race right before ours.
Yeah. Okay. So we did from a dead stop, and I fucking wheelied, and... To the stops, to that sign, he beat me. I lost way too much in there.
The launch fucks,
but I was sucking his ass up so fucking fast.
Right.
That, yes, I would have beat him if it was 5 more feet, but this, you know.
So that's where let's roll in to it.
Yeah, because, no matter what, dude, if it was you, I mean, you had a chain drive and all that shit, you would have locked up too and fucking just wheelie that motherfucker.
Absolutely.
So,
don't disagree.
I mean, your bike's got power. Mine's got power. Mm. Hell, Larry's does too, but he just did a better job of keeping the front end down.
Right.
But I think he's been practicing since I kicked his ass the last time.
Okay.
So he was working on
it. But he got rid of the bike.
He did.
Okay. So null and void, doesn't matter.
Yeah, it does. I got rid of mine, so null and void too now. So, but I mean, to be fair, just to be honest, I think that even if it was further, I still feel like my bike would have probably still had yours.
Continued to pull.
Okay. Because I did feel like my shit was still pulling. But to be fair with you as well, you know, like the joke is like, because you messaged me like a couple weeks ago and said, hey, I got more stuff done to my bike. And I'm like, well, mine's still stock. Right?
Yes. But, I would love to dive into that shit.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So that is precisely why I chose a Challenger and why I built the Challenger. I rode a stock one. Mm-hmm. We painted a stock one last year.
Yeah, I remember that one.
It was fucking sweet. He said, go out and try to break it. Challenge accepted. I went out solo. I went out two up. Rode the fuck out of it. Couldn't break it. I could not believe the way that bike handled. I mean... Cornering, braking, power. This is stock. Holy shit.
Yeah.
This is nothing like that 2020 Road Glide sitting over there. It's just not.
It's not at all.
So I said, all right, I'm going to buy one of these motherfuckers. I don't know how, I don't know when, but I'm doing it. Like, this bike changed my mind on motorcycles in general. So I got it. I built it. Now all of a sudden Jace wants to race. And I'm like, fucking A, let's do it. So
I don't even remember...
Dude,
I'm trying to remember. Like, I know that I think that it started when they first released them. I think the thing got real fucked up because FXR Mike and a few other friends like him were fucking with me because I was kind of
talking shit about him.
Yeah, everybody was.
Shout out FXR Mike for sticking up for me all these times. I love you, Goldwing Mike.
Yeah,
my man. I got to meet him at the camp out, by the way.
Yeah,
he was so cool.
Yeah,
yeah. So here's the only thing I have to say about that. You beat me fair and square. I will never. You and I are the only ones that know.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I seen the videos. I get why people say what they say. I get it. Never once did I say, fuck that, I won. Never.
Mm-hmm.
Look, that bike, aside from the fact that we both have to tune it aftermarket,
mm-hmm.
right? We got to put a good tune in it. Let's cross that off the list. It doesn't matter what it costs. Yeah. Actually, my tune was 700. Yours is ThunderMax. Yeah. Where they sell those for 800, 900?
Yeah, something like that. 10% off Fast Life offer code.
Yeah, shout out ThunderMax, Jake. Okay, so the tune, forget it. The pipe. We both need a pipe, not only because it makes the bike better, but it looks better, sounds better.
Yeah.
Forget the cost of the pipe. It's off the list. Air cleaner. It's not even talk about that. Okay, I put $700 worth of cams in that bike. And by the way, I didn't even have the bike tuned at the time. It had a stock tune in it. Okay. Now it has an aftermarket tune from Lloyd's Garage.
Mm-hmm.
It's a fucking monster, dude. We would not be neck and neck anymore. I mean, we would still be neck and neck, but you would not be winning anymore at this point. I promise you.
Okay.
You need to ride this motorcycle. Just.
I'm not saying that. I honestly believe that. I know that they rip. Like, I know they do. It's impossible for them not to. They built the right type of motor, and
right.
the bike is full of cheap, flimsy parts all over it that aren't fucking that thick.
Agree. Dude, I have done my best to deal with it.
Yeah.
Some of them I even fucking threw away and put other parts in their place, like Behringer hand controls. And I.
So you tackled everything that I was like, I did initially. Yeah.
I totally understand that. Yeah. And I agree with you. You're correct. The standpoint I'd like to make is that I put $700 into the bike. True.
And I put 6,000.
You put 6,000 in it and you barely beat me. End of story. I'm the winner.
For sure.
Okay. And that's what's awesome about all of this.
Yeah.
To the racing with Tyler O'Hara, Kyle Wyman, and what you and I are talking about, it gets these dudes that are down as fuck, super cool, homies, talking shit, and it's all for the greater cause of all of it.
And the thing is, like,
none of us are being fucking dumb about it.
At the end of the day,
that's what this is so awesome.
Let's say that you just smoked my ass, right? I'm not gonna like the rest of the camp out. I'm not talking to you. You know what I mean? Like, that's the difference. And there's people out there like that. You know what I mean?
Yes, like, I do.
I love the fact that, you know, I could have totally. No, I'm not even gonna say that. Larry got me. He got me.
Yeah.
We can all say I wish the finish line was 5 more feet.
But that was just a race. That's not a race. That's not bike for bike.
Yeah.
You and I will both sit here and go on record saying we both had a fair start.
Yeah, neither one of us jumped.
I will say that I fucked up on my second to third shift. Mm-hmm. I absolutely did. But I'm not going to say that's why I lost the race, okay? Mm-hmm. But you and I were neck and neck, fair and square. Racing's racing.
Yeah.
Rubbing is racing, right? But let's be honest. After the race, you and I were just like, we kind of went in shutdown mode, right? Like, everybody wanted to know.
Well, it was weird because I didn't realize that they couldn't see.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I didn't realize that, like, from where they were standing, they couldn't see it. And all they saw was basically the person that passed them up there first.
Well, I just want you to know that I took most of the glory.
You did.
Unintentionally.
Yeah, because everybody, you know, thought. But I was like, you know what? I noticed that. But at the same time, to my point, it wasn't about going up there and saying that no, I won.
You absolutely. Because at no point did I tell anybody that I won.
Yeah.
I told everybody I kept the fuck up. And I didn't spend $6,000. That was the only thing I said. So with that being said, I'm so fucking proud of that motorcycle.
Yeah.
I do love that motorcycle. It is not a fucking Harley. It will never be a Harley. And to come all the way back around full circle, if you said 23, if the 23 Rogue Glide is a new platform redefined, fuck yeah, I'm down. Like, I'm not an Indian guy per se. I do love that bike, just a motorcycle.
The word on the street is...
I like motorcycles, so...
Pan America motor bigger in the touring chassis. Or a new chassis, but...
Okay, I could see that. Did you see the... You probably didn't see the Sportster stuff today. did you?
So is that officially the new Sportster?
I don't know. I did see like a grid. It's on my phone. I was just going to look. Yeah. There's like a grid that shows comparable motorcycles in different manufacturers and what this bike offers versus those bikes.
Yeah.
And while this new Sportster is the most expensive, it has...
What's the price range on it?
I want to say it was like $14,900.
That's still not too
or
bad.
Or $16,900.
$16,900.
Fair enough. But it had like 120 horse from the factory.
Mm-hmm.
They finally went to a six-speed on a Sportster. That's huge. Shout out to Saxon. Saxon and his fucking chick bikes.
Yeah.
They're going six-speed. Water-cooled.
Yeah.
Yo, water-cooled, 120 horsepower on a sporty...
It's got room to grow.
After seeing what the Livewire puts out and the Pan America,
yeah.
I think that they're finally fucking onto something. So
you would I'm stoked. I'm not one of those I'm a Harley dude 100%, but I'm not one of those like it has to be air cooled guys. I don't want a V-Rod.
Fair enough.
But my stance has always been I want a modular bike that can do more than just one thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't, you know, the thing that makes the Sportster so great, and I think we were talking about it on the last podcast with Jacob. They can be whatever you want: a chopper, a flat track bike, a drag bike, a stunt bike, a performance touring bike. They can be everything,
mm-hmm.
you know. But some of these bikes that they were initially releasing, I think they scratched a couple of them from Harley when they were releasing this new motor. Like some of these look like they can only do one thing. The Indian FTR. Fucking badass bike. It's not modular. You're not jumping on that bike and riding it across country.
Yep.
It's just not
designed for that. It's just a fast, go fast bike.
Yeah.
I mean, it just
looks know, in a sense, the Livewire's that way. Right. I rode one. Fucking blows my mind.
So I said that today about the Sportster, because they did, whether the info was completely factual or not, they did release a photo.
Yeah.
Let's assume that's correct. And the first thing I said in our group chat was, good luck making that a bobber. And I use the term bobber because I'm thinking drag bars and forward controls looking like a fucking dweeb.
So does it have?
It's very live wire.
Where is the pegs on this one? Is it mid controls?
I didn't even look that close.
I didn't either.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to own one because if it's the same size as a sporty or an FTR, it doesn't fit my budget and needs in life to justify owning it. Same with the Softail. The new Softails, I've ridden them. I've road tripped on them. Stock version, bone stock. They're okay. I wasn't mad at it.
Yeah.
I could see the potential. For once in the first time ever, I could feel the potential in a Harley.
Yeah.
In the M8 Softail. But I can't justify dropping 20, 30, 40 G's into a Softail with no bags, no tour pack option, that kind of thing. Even if you throw the Pelican shit on it, it's just not a touring bike. You're still a little crammed up.
That's ultimately why, you know, initially when I was selling my bike, I was thinking of going Lowrider S. But the more and more that I thought about it, I just couldn't go backwards in a sense.
So going backwards, yes. But then I also follow that up with looking at the trips you've been taking with all the Texas homies.
Yeah.
All Softails.
Yeah. The thing is that they are all Softails, but they also not really ever had a performance bagger. So they don't really know what it's like. How much
better it can get.
Yeah, exactly. For
comfort and...
Trust me, I see these bikes in so many angles, and like Big Will Cody and James and, you know, Jones and Kyle, all these dudes have really, really sick ass Softails.
Right.
You know, even Dirty Larry Softail was one of the dopest fat bobs there was.
Right.
You know, but I just don't think that could not be my only bike.
Right.
Like I want one, but not as the only bike. Same thing with the Pan America.
Right.
I want one, but then not as an only bike.
Then you have to ask yourself, like when you're at home, you're working, daily grind, going home to the wife, watching movies, going out to dinner. Where does that bike fit in? You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. It seems to me like, do you ride your bike to work every day or do you drive to work every day?
I used to ride every day, but since I got a new Jeep, I've been like...
Okay, yeah, but different. Since the Jeep, but before that, like the last 2 years?
Yeah, I used to ride quite a bit, you know? Okay. Like a lot of the miles that are on my bike probably came from commuting.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But the the only thing that after I took that trip to Maine, I found myself craving a skinny bike. I wanted to ride something skinny, nimble, and just smaller, just not to travel on, but just to jump on, to go to the work, go home, like just something easy, sure. Right? Not that the bagger's hard, it's just big.
Commuting wise. Yeah. It's like once you spend some time in California on the highways.
It wasn't even California. It was just in general. Like this year, let's look at this year. Mm-hmm. All right. March, beginning of March, I rode to San Francisco. That was a 4,500 mile trip, right? Then I backed it up with going to Maine and back. That was a 4,500 mile trip as well. Mm-hmm. And then not saying that this trip is included in that bike, but this is a 1,000-mile trip right now that I'm on the way home from.
Right.
All on a big bike, you know, and it's only been 4 months. Like, that's almost 10,000 miles in 4 months, you know what I'm saying? And right. I'm not that's even trying. That's yeah. not including the camp out.
Yeah,
that's not including the polar ride, which isn't super long. I mean, it's just a lot. And then I'm going to fucking Sturgis in 4 weeks from, you know, technically today, Tuesday. Right. So it's
what's that like
for me?
1,800 miles?
No, for me, it's Sturgis is right at 11. If I go the fastest way,
1,100.
Yeah,
that's so strange because from where we sit,
mm-hmm.
it's like 1,000 miles.
Yeah,
well, so it's weird.
The funny thing is, I was thinking about this today. Like, I know exactly if you put a pin and a string that was 1,000 miles out on a map from mm-hmm. my house, I know just about everywhere in the country that hits that mark.
Sure.
So from my house to Chicago is 1,000 miles. My house to,
wow,
you know, you hit the circle and it goes just before, but yeah. same thing, like it's 1,100 miles to Phoenix. And you know what I mean? Like, I just know all that radius because gotcha. We do it so much.
Well,
I don't know. I wouldn't mind having a second bike that's more skinny that I don't have to hop on the Road Glide every time to go do just to work and back or to lunch right. or to bike night, things like that. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I kind of want that. And that's, I have the FXR, but. You know, I was going to try to build it for Sturgis or do something to it for Sturgis, but there's just no parts available.
Yeah.
Ain't well, shit.
I definitely would love to, I don't know, my problem is I love to have numerous motorcycles, numerous styles, but I always got to rob Peter to pay Paul as far as,
yeah.
if I'm going to build this, I got to sell this.
Yeah.
And so I'm just not there in life right now. I get it. I'm right yeah, there with yeah. you.
I'm. You know, I think, you know, one of the things that... like we were talking about earlier, not getting too much into what we were talking about earlier, but just like being at this point, like I feel like in a sense, and probably you can attest to it because of what you've done with the Challenger, your last bike, those got a lot of publicity. They did a lot in the scene, right? So in a sense, it's like you have an opportunity right now to probably get the best opportunities to showcase your talents. Mm-hmm. And I'm starting to feel that way. Like I need to find a way to open up the door to allow a couple more bigger projects that I would be honored to have my name on,
right.
in a sense.
Yeah.
And kind of make myself available for that to do it because of the timing and the fact that our brand is, you know, doing yeah. well and things like that.
You
know?
And I are at a weird crossroads because you're able to schedule out life and work to do the traveling mm-hmm. and do that side. Where I'm not.
Yeah.
Where I'm here putting the work in on the builds where you're not. See what yeah. I'm saying? Like, you're capable of doing these builds.
I just, there's no yeah, way
there's
I could.
There's so much yeah. to get done with just life and work and all that, where my mindset has always been just keep working, keep working, mm-hmm. keep working. And that's clearly how I've gotten to the point I'm at. You just keep your nose to the grindstone and someday it's going to pay off. Well, yeah. it's funny because that's exactly what just in meeting you in the last few years has been my inspiration, meeting you, meeting Steve, to get out and enjoy life a little bit more.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And
well, so, it pays off too, because the thing is that like,
well, yeah, absolutely.
The thing that I know that the podcast has had a help in the same way that Proper Baggers has had a help in with their presence on mm-hmm. Instagram is the community that we built around this and how everybody supports each other, mm-hmm. supports each other has been one of the things that where, you know, when you come and invest in it, when you put into that pot, you put food on the table that we all eat off of,
right?
you just, things kind of go better for you.
They do.
Opportunities come.
As long as there's no drama, right?
Yeah, and there's no drama right now because right. we're all friends and we're keeping it that way. And
right.
we do a good job of shooing off the drama, right?
Yep.
And but it's also one of those things that, like, you know, I hope this shit lasts for years and years to come.
Right.
But, you know.
Yeah, it's weird to think where we'll be at 5 to 10 years from now. You know what I'm saying?
I was thinking about that on the way down here, you know, because...
Dude, I already have my thoughts. I think like dudes like you and I, like I aspire to put the miles on like you do or like Steve does. And that's kind of what my whole goal is here, is like keep building bikes, but allow it to let me just do what I want to do. Right. Mm-hmm. And with that, it's traveling, because I've fallen in love with that so much through the last few years. So I think that ultimately 5 to 10 years from now, as we get older into the New Balance jort age, I think we all end up on Gold Wings and BMWs and we say, fuck all of this. Let's just enjoy our friendships and let's just go ride. Like, it's always going to come down to the ride.
You know why I don't think we're going to be doing that?
I think it's true.
When I think of all the people, when I think of the industry that I grew up in and the industry that I'm still growing up in now,
yep.
and I look at the people that have influenced and pushed it and carried trends and carried the custom motorcycle industry for the last 20 years, almost 20 years that I've been a part of it. These are dudes that were in their 40s and their 50s and 60s even.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I'm not there yet. I'm not even that. I'm not even 40 yet.
Right.
And to already feel like, you know, we have an influence on it. You know what I mean? Like,
sure.
I feel like it just grows from here.
You're saying this is just the beginning.
Yeah.
I understand that.
You know, and I think that the difference is that because we've had such great teachers before us,
yep.
I think that we get to see a lot more of what they've dealt with and how they handled pushing and growing the scene, mm-hmm. that we get to see, okay, let's avoid this. Let's avoid that.
Yeah, you know what to do, what not to do.
You know, let's find a way to support each other, because all the times in our motorcycle industry when shops did support, there was growth in it. And then when it became like shit talking and trash talking and badgering,
mm-hmm.
things fell apart. So we see that. We have a social media reference to go back to and see where things fell apart.
True.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
it's like a dictionary.
Yeah. So it's like we can see this. So let's not do that, you know? Right. And
definitely done a good job of avoiding it so far.
Yeah. I mean, I also think that none of us are big enough to create that much. You see the bigger names trying to step into this,
mm-hmm.
and the commotion they try to start.
But the whole scene is based off of such a small enough community to where it's large, but small people.
Yeah.
To where when banded together, they'll take down the big ones every single
true.
Time.
True. So there's brands that, you know, I don't want to say any names. I won't say the names on the bad ones.
Fair enough.
But they come in and they try to bully their way in by talking shit about someone else that is respected.
Right.
As opposed to, let's say, Arlen Ness, who's making performance bagger products, but they're just, hey, man, check out these new things. If you want them, cool. Here they are.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not going to say that ours are better than everybody else's or worse. This is just what we have if you guys want options.
Right.
And that's what we need, is people to come in here and give options so these bikes have a little bit more diversity to them.
Right. That's been the best part of it, is seeing the big names that you're talking about coming in and doing the bullying, the just our normal type dudes that are into this kind of stuff, they know better than to buy into that.
Yeah.
They really do. And it's very impressive. I mean, it's almost like applaudable. Like,
well, that's
good job,
saying.
Guys.
There's,
but you still get the new dudes coming in, and they buy into that shit.
And
that's
those
who's
dudes,
getting sucked up. And
yeah, those dudes outnumber
in.
Us 10 to 1, though.
Absolutely.
You know, those are the performance bagger pages on Facebook.
Absolutely. Which, dude, I'm still admin on, and I just fucking can't even keep up on anymore. I can't.
Yeah.
Like, with everything I got going on in the shop, I feel so bad that I'm not trying as much as I was. I was doing a great job of it. Now,
you're doing a great job of crushing people's dreams.
Dude,
there's
fucking, I would have to look it up, but we got over 30,000 members right now.
Yeah.
I'm saying there's probably, like, we don't approve. You have to approve every post that gets made. I would say if I click on that every hour, there's at least 10 posts waiting to be approved. and it's the same fucking shit all day, every day.
Yeah.
And you get to the point where you're like, do we need to keep doing the same thing over and over and over again? Use the search bar, right?
Yeah.
But then you're also like, well, what about all the new dudes that didn't see the content? And so you accept it. Well, then the OGs on the page are like, we've already been through this. And like, you can't fucking please everyone.
You can't win either.
It's so annoying. But overall, it's good. Yeah. It is going very well. The like bashing / shaming thing, like to go back to like what you and John Jessup talked about, that heated, very good informational conversation. There's not as much of that going on.
Yeah.
Anymore. I would say that we've really learned our lessons from all that shit for a public type setting, you know, versus someone's personal Instagram page or whatever, but it's going pretty good. But what it's doing is just blowing up the mainstream more and more and more and more. So is that good? I don't know. It's one of those bittersweet things.
It's like, you know, It is going to grow exponentially because the cost of you know the cost of entry is very cheap to some people's standards.
Yeah.
Right.
But you get to a point where there's so many people.
You can't. Yeah. You can't. Yeah.
I mean, and you said it in a podcast. I don't remember which one, but just recently here, you said, I'm almost to the point where, you know what? My circle's full. I'm done. It's close.
Yeah.
I can't bring any more people in. I honestly feel the same way. I have so many good people that I couldn't possibly need any more good people in my life. I just, and there's room for those good people. There is, but it's like, I'm so content with who I'm surrounded by and who supports me. And you know, how much does a guy need before it starts to get to your head to where you're like,
yeah.
Ooh, now I got to be that asshole on social media. And like you do.
That's one thing you never, I think that us personally, like myself, you, a lot of people that are in this scene, I don't think that we're ever a real asshole. I think that maybe people that don't know us could take it that way.
Yeah.
You know, but I'll be honest with you. I don't really see myself or most of us ever getting to that Jesse James standard of life. I think that we'll grow in our notoriety or popularity within the motorcycle industry and maybe other surrounding ones around it. But it'll always be, I think it'll always be manageable. You know what I mean? Like,
well,
even if I had 100 or you had 100,000 followers, it's like there's still going to be that core group and the people that you go hang out with. And don't get me wrong, like you'll still probably want to go to a camp out and have all these things that you want to do for fun. And there's going to be people there that want to meet you and talk to you and finally get to, you know, tell them what they tell them, you know, oh man, I heard that podcast you did. And so I just been wanting to tell you this, you know, and I get it, man, because it's a very new thing that, you know, people, dude, I can't, I've already said in the last podcast, I'm going to say it one more time. The amount of people that reach out about finding inspiration through the conversations that they listen to on this podcast is overwhelming.
Yeah.
You know absolutely. What I mean?
I don't see that from the immediate podcast side, but just in general, we talked about it earlier, man. I get 10 messages a day from just dudes that just want to know more about me and ask me questions and just have a random conversation. And I'm always usually pretty quick to respond and very cordial, where I know you don't respond to all of them because there's just so many of them.
Yeah.
Where I try to remain humble and give everyone the same amount of respect and time of day. You know what I'm saying?
It's weird because I was thinking about that just now, what you were just saying, and I'm trying to think, like, I get usually the ones that when someone really writes me something, I read it and I respond to them, right? But also, I try to keep it the response to like it doesn't become an
open invite to keep talking.
Because, it, you know, like sometimes, you know, I don't spend a lot of time on social media. Right. I really don't. Like people might think I do, but I post whatever I need to put out there and then I put my phone down and I go back to work.
Right.
I literally wear an Apple Watch right now and I leave my phone in a part of the shop that I'm not at so that if some actual message comes through that I need to know,
right,
or a text message, then I can get to it. But ultimately, man, like when people were on there and they're you know, the general question that I get 400 times a day is, how much for a helmet? How much for a helmet? How much, right, for a helmet? I just got a new helmet. Can I send it to you? How long's the wait? How long's that all day long, to the point where I get it, you know, like I can, you can, on social media, on Instagram, you can make a post explaining everything that you do and how you do it right there. And someone will still email you or comment and, right, ask the question that was just fucking said.
It's like when I put a for sale ad up that has literally everything you could ever ask, but they still ask you,
yeah,
in an email. And it's like, y'all didn't realize I spent 20 minutes on this fucking, yeah, write-up so that I didn't have to deal with you dumb motherfuckers.
The people that take the time to invest in us are, mm-hmm, the people that kind of want to be here. And then there's a lot of people that are just like passing by, like, oh, that looks interesting. How much?
Yeah, you almost hate to say just like general public, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I get it.
I mean, there's dudes that reach out to me that even say, like, man, I really wish I could afford a helmet. Just give me the spiel, but they're not asking me to do anything for free. They're just telling me how they feel. And yeah, I'm like, dude, I appreciate it, man. I honestly wish that I was still 21 hanging out in the garage painting all my friends shit for free. That was probably one of the most funnest times of my life.
Right.
You know, but I got child support and shit. So, you know,
and a new Jeep. I fucking hate Jeeps. What is this Jeep? Speak of it.
We got,
is
my
it a
wife.
Wrangler?
No, fuck no. I got a Grand Cherokee.
Okay, I approve.
That's like a
fine.
Man.
That's fine. Yeah. Jeep Wranglers, fuck off. You take your doors and your roof off. Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, no. I was torn between that and the Toyota 4Runner.
Oof. Okay. So
the 4Runner was more expensive and shittier gas mileage.
My driveway, it's nothing but Toyotas.
I know.
I am
you and
Zim, die hard.
You and Chris had, yeah. Chris just got a sick ass one not too long ago.
Yeah. Well, he did like the bargain for the buck.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. Ton of miles, decent shape, saved a lot of money. Which is great because that fucking truck will go to 500,000, yeah, no problem. So that's the difference in Jeep and Toyota. Toyota is going to go to 500K, Jeep's not. Well, but Toyota is overpriced and the gas mileage is not amazing.
Yeah.
That's the give and the take from it.
So my wife has a Cherokee, not the Grand Cherokee. She's, mm-hmm, had it for a couple of years. And just hanging out, driving with her and that every once in a while, I'm like, man, I like the interiors. They're very comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
It's like Grand Cherokee's a little bit bigger. And the thing was, I needed to, you know, I needed to do a couple road trip podcasts.
Mm-hmm.
And also take all the camera equipment to do some shoots on bikes and things like that. So, unfortunately, like, those kind of trips won't be bike ones that I take on the trip. But there's just a lot of, like, with photography now, there's a lot more equipment that has to go places.
I was hoping you were going to say hauling parts.
No, I don't mind doing that.
Yeah.
You know, I look at it like, fuck, man, let's just say if you were painting something here and you needed me to pick it up, but then I could come up here and set up a podcast with Bare Knuckle Paul, Sit Down Steve, Marshall, Tucker, and then
is it time for Junkyard Kenny or no?
Yeah, but isn't he in Chicago though?
No, he's St. Louis.
Okay,
Alton, which is an hour from.
He can come to Dallas.
Let him come to Dallas.
Yeah,
Junkyard Kenny. Okay.
Honestly, man, like,
you hear that, Kenny? He'll be there.
No, I want him to. I'd love to do it. I wish that I could do more podcasts in the shop because it's better.
That's no, I totally understand that. And yeah, I'm going to do a podcast there with you. I promise you I will. I was going to ask you that was on my to-do list, was seeing all the shit you talked about stunt riders previously.
Yeah.
And I know Sit Down Steve, I know Junkyard Kenny. You've somehow become like close to Steve. Sit Down Steve.
Well, I think,
which is strange.
Steve, yeah, because when he pissed in my studio.
Yeah, which is strange. End of, like, period. Leave it at that. It's strange. You're now friends with Steve, and that's cool. Steve's awesome.
Yeah.
How are you going to bring on Sit Down Steve and not bring on Junkyard Kenny?
Well, first off, I'm not a fanboy of stunt riders.
I don't really know
who's the who or not.
Well,
look, here's the deal. I've never had it wasn't that I had an issue with stunt riders. I really didn't. It's just that, like, when Zach was apprenticing for me last year, mm-hmm. he opened my eyes to things that I hadn't noticed because I grew up in sport bikes.
Sure.
Right. So I was around every fucking wheelie, left, right. I've seen it all. Like, it just didn't, it wasn't doing anything for me. Right.
Right.
Not that I didn't like it.
Well, because how far can you take stunt riding?
Yeah. Because it just got to, right. And also you got to understand, like, as a painter, you know how many fucking stunt riders
want their bike painted for free?
Work for and never panned out to do shit. And then also how many stunt riders ask me all the time to do shit for them. Right.
Right.
Even sit down, Stevie's like trying to get me to paint shit from all the time. And I'm just like, dude, we're not, that's not who we are. We don't do that together.
Right.
You know, yep. Just,
I understand.
But so at the same time, it's like, I do want to have these guys on, but you got to understand, like, stunt riders are fucking, you got to be ready for them. You got to pad the walls and you got to do a lot of shit. You got to stunt proof your fucking shop.
Grown ass children.
Yeah.
Yep.
And so you get too many in one room and you can't fucking handle
you
it.
You think sit down, Steve's wild. Wait till you get Junkyard Kenny, bro.
Steve has told me everything about this dude.
You got to make it happen.
I'm down to, I think that what Steve, I think what all these dudes have been doing the last couple of years mm-hmm. is amazing. Because
it is, yeah.
Here's the difference between like Junkyard Kenny, even CJ Barham, and a lot of these dudes that have been doing this like tour with these guys, yep. You know, most of Harley stunt riding has kind of been this thing they were doing on this, you know, here and there, but these guys, they have a personality, right? They mm-hmm. brought a personality to it. So now it's like you see the Sit Down Steve show and the CJ Barham show sure. and the Junkyard Kenny show.
Yeah.
And that's more entertaining to me because realistically, they're all doing the same fucking tricks.
Right.
So what makes it interesting it's almost is all who
about,
they are.
Yeah, it's almost about how it's edited and what was chosen yeah. to be filmed and uploaded. So and yeah.
what Steve and all these guys started doing with Daytona this year and all this, like, the stuff is, it inspires people to ride, and I'm all about that shit. Whatever gets people to want to get into this, right. I'm down with it. But I'm also, you know, the reason why we did the hood ride was not to fluff my name. It was to give all the stunt riders in Dallas some fucking exposure.
I got you.
You know what I mean? And it helped a lot of them out. But, you know, it's the same thing. It's like I'm trying to bring brands to the town to witness some of the local talent, to see some of this shit, mm-hmm. and maybe something happens, right? I don't make any money on it. Right. I just use my name because it has a little bit of fucking followers and maybe they'll come and watch. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Well, it's a cool demographic to get behind. I mean, there's a lot of good names out there and I've met a lot of these dudes and I think they would be willing to
give
you the time of day, you know? Like Tallboy T is yeah. so sick. Seabear, obviously. But I think now that you started with Steve, you can't stop.
No, Steve. Look,
I say that from a long time podcast supporter.
Well, Steve's one of those guys that's going to be, he's a friend, right? He's became a friend over the last couple of months. He was a huge, huge help and benefit to the camp out this year. Yeah. He really was because I'm not that guy. Like he has no problem getting out there with a mic and being
right.
That's just not who I am.
Yep.
You know what I mean? He helped out. He made the camp out fun. The Sit Down Steve version of the Fast Life camp out is a great camp out.
Yeah.
Right. I'm still not paying him for fucking being there. So you can kiss my ass. I'm paying him with exposure.
Yeah.
So I'm down for that. I think that the stunt rider, what they brought to the camp out is fun. And people get to have that with the people that fucking smashed all over the country with everything. Like, that's what it's about, is bringing all these motherfuckers together and just putting me in one pot and seeing what happens.
It's almost like you can't do an event without a sun show anymore. It's almost what it's turned into.
True. You know, I think that anytime, I mean, with what we do out there, it's just like, it's just funner. You know what I mean? It's just like, I mean.
It brings that one moment of 20 to 30 minutes of
just
fuck shit show. Like
you should have saw the stunt show that was that like Lot Lizard and our other homie Kenny did up in the Talamina. Like there's this one spot that we always go to.
Yeah,
dude, fuck, it's like a circle. They were doing burnouts. It was a fucking like private stunt show
during the camp out.
Yeah, but it was up in the mountains while we were riding.
Yeah, Talamina,
fucking awesome. But yeah, that's kind of things I do want to do more with stunt riders. But you understand, man, like. With the podcast, you know, it could quickly go down a rabbit hole of like stunt rider, stunt rider, stunt rider, and then it becomes uninteresting to certain demographics.
Yeah. So you have to. Yeah, I just think now that you've lifted it, you got to kind of
keep
going with it. So,
I mean, I want to do a it's a podcast, man. Like, the goal from day one was to basically use the Joe Rogan, you know, method of podcasting and try to bring on every aspect of the motorcycle world that I am interested in. And I feel like I can have a conversation with
that
them.
That you are interested in or your followers?
No, I'm interested in.
Okay.
Because if the problem is if I'm not interested in it, I don't know how to have a conversation. Therefore, I do not do the guest justice or the listener's justice.
But do you think after Sit Down Steve, you're not particularly
interested? No, I am. I am, though. Okay. I'm interested in...
It's changed.
I'm not interested in doing it. Right. I'm interested in it, understanding it and seeing how these dudes work.
Just bringing it into the scene, accepting it, showing the old farts, whom we call bikers and hell yeah brothers, that, hey, this is who's coming. Get on board or get the fuck out. Like, you're not getting a choice.
I get guys every day that hit me up and tell me about this old biker that works at a shop in middle of nowhere, Alabama, that has the best stories. I'm like, I don't disagree that this dude probably has the best stories. But when you have a substantial audience like we've got with this podcast, they kind of start to trust you that when you put a podcast out, it's worth their time.
Like, it's just going to get better and better and better.
Well, not every podcast is going to be like your cup of tea.
Right.
Right? Not everyone's going to be like, I enjoyed that one. Right. Sometimes you might start one that's like, I'm not really feeling it today. I'm kind of sick of Jace's voice. I get it. Right. But the goal.
Nobody ever says that.
Yeah.
Okay. Nobody. They don't. Everybody. No, that's not a compliment to you. Nobody ever says that. That's not what it's about. From a listener to the producer.
Yeah.
It's not about your voice.
Yeah. They might hear it all the time. So.
But it's usually waiting for the moment for you to say the word fag.
And I don't say it anymore.
You're a bullshit fucking liar.
When did I say it last?
Probably the main podcast. When Dragon was going off. Dragon,
oh, I did say it.
Dragon, you need to chill the fuck out. I love you, Dragon. Chill out.
He's my boy. He's got my back.
He went extra deep on that one. Okay.
I think I went to the bathroom when he was going off.
He went off. He went deep. But... for good reason, because the dude on the receiving end, I think we're both a little warm, a little toasty, a little tipsy right now.
Yeah.
We should avoid that subject, because we will not stop.
You know what's crazy is, like, when me and Steve and Rennie did that Patreon podcast, we kind of went hard on them too.
Yeah.
I actually lost a lot of Patreon supporters on that one.
Did you really?
Mm-hmm.
You know what, though?
I don't know if it's for that, but it happened afterwards.
I understand, but it's hard to say, like, what is the objective here? You know what I'm saying? Like, is it for Cali? Because you know that's part of it.
Yeah.
Or is it for myself? Is it for my own being? Boosting the followers, proving a point, getting the wife to pat me on the back, or...
the amount of people that live around him,
or is it
they reached out and said, like, yeah, that dude's a fucking weirdo here. Nobody likes him.
Yeah, and you kept saying NorCal.
Yeah, that's where that dude's from.
Ventura.
That's where he was from?
Pretty sure.
I thought he was from NorCal.
I don't think so, bro. I think he's from Ventura.
Well, I got a lot of homies in Ventura.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Man. He fucks with my garage a lot.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, you know what? The thing about it, man, like, all honesty, I wish that, you know, I wish that people would understand that, like, my opinions come from an honest place, and it's not to discredit anybody else.
A lot of people,
because all the dudes that he tagged, I've ridden with those guys.
Absolutely.
You know,
that's what I'm saying, is like, that's why it's like, is this for California, or what's the objective? And the only thing I can take from it is I just feel bad for his wife. I don't know what else to say. Like, how do you live with that? Like, that mindset is exhausting. What's your goal? What are you trying to do?
Well, I think what happens is it's a speculation. This is another opinion that could get people mad, but I think that I think that what we have on this side of the country is pretty awesome, right?
And camaraderie.
It's camaraderie.
And respect.
And support. Everybody supports each other. Absolutely. And I'm not going to say that that doesn't exist out there in California. I'm not going to say that because it definitely does. Mm-hmm. But across the board?
You think it's lesser? Few and far between?
Yeah, because there's so many more shops. There's so many more people. Because
it's the OG.
Yeah.
I get that. You know what? That's why there's this little thing. It's called a sticker. There's even t-shirts. And you know what it says? We don't give a fuck how they do it in California. Look, dude. I grew up in fucking North Dakota, okay?
Yeah.
That is fucking nowhere. Like, call it Canada, call it Montana. It's fucking nowhere. There's nothing there, okay? Yeah. If I can grow up in that motherfucker for 24 years and do what I'm doing today, believe me, California has nothing to do with it. I mean, sure, there's things that are built there. Maybe there's sources of inspiration, but I wasn't handed nothing. And I'm out here doing the damn thing. Yeah. So just keeping it real.
Yeah.
I don't care, dude. Like, I've already been through it with this dude, and it's a lost fucking cause. Like,
yeah.
That's what you and I want to sit and preach about and go over about back and forth is the respect and the love and how everybody gets along and there's no drama until the big names come in, try to bully. Over it. Like,
it's hard.
These dudes need to realize that this is like a lost cause and you're not going to win.
Ultimately, man, like what I wish would happen is, I just wish that more people would get on board with, not on board, that's the wrong. I just wish people would do more traveling, more riding of their bike. And maybe out there in California where he has some of the best riding fucking 5 minutes from his house and he doesn't have to go earn it.
It starts in the morning, ends at the end of the day.
Yeah.
I get that. I do. I've lived that too, and I agree with you. I really do. I mean, that's where the best experiences come from. That's where those bonds come from, and it makes a lot of sense.
And you know, to be honest with you, if anybody listens to the whole conversation with me and John Jessup, first off, me and John Jessup are really good friends, mm-hmm. right? And that's how real men talk, is they both have an opinion, and they talk about it. And at the end of that conversation, you know, whether I don't even remember if we agree to disagree or whatever the case, it was just more of like, look, my perspective is this. Those dudes, those OG dudes in the Harley scene, doing Willie's Big Manny, all these other guys, White Boy John, all these guys, whatever they were doing is not what we are doing.
Right.
Right?
Yep. And then so, you end the conversation without getting butthurt. You agree to disagree.
Yeah.
And we remain homies, and let's continue forward.
Yeah,
supporting each other.
And then if everybody would go listen to the podcast that I did with Modified Vision, which is Brian, mm-hmm. who is a big guy in the NorCal scene, has been working in Harley dealerships and Ness for the last like 15 years, I think. He even talks about remembering like in 2004, doing the work to put on a set of West Coast T-bars on a fucking...
I listened to it.
On a bagger in 2004. It's like, look, nobody's saying that this shit didn't...
It's not about I did this first.
Yeah.
It's like people want to take that and put it on this podium, try to take credit because that makes you the best or the coolest or the most relevant. It's not the case. It's just about getting out and being yourself. And if yourself is someone who's cool as shit and respectable yeah. and... supportive, helpful, just down to earth. You're our people.
Yeah.
That's who we're trying to fuck with.
End of like story. I said, there's, I would say one of the OGs of our style of bike in NorCal is Mod Glide. He was yeah. one of the original dudes out there doing it.
Yeah.
Some of the original custom bikes were done by San Diego Customs and mm-hmm. Danny G's, like 14 and 15.
Right.
Nobody's saying these bikes don't exist, and nobody's saying that they're the only ones that can be air quotes. OG. It's
right.
I mean, this thing's so young, man. Who fucking knows? And half these people might be on to some other trend in 2 years. You know what I mean?
I completely agree. At the end of the day, I'll just try to love everybody. Honestly.
Man, I want to see more people riding bikes.
Yeah,
and I feel
that's
like so many people, if they when they ride them, they don't have time to get wrapped up in these thought bubbles that put them in negative places. You know yep. what I'm saying? I'm the same way. When I sit here and think about when I don't get out and ride, when I'm just trapped in my own thoughts and something happens on the internet and makes me feel a certain way, I get the same way. It's human nature to yeah. to get riled up about something that you don't agree with or see differently. But at the end of the day, like, I don't get out and make it known because it doesn't benefit me. If I have a problem with somebody and it really is fucking with me to the point,
you try to take it out with them.
I need to talk to them on a private level.
Man to man.
When this dude was sending me all these messages and tagging me and shit, I clearly said, hey, man, can we talk on the phone about this?
Right.
And he never responded to me. So right. It's like, you don't want to talk about it.
It comes off as troll instantly.
Yeah. You don't want to have a real conversation. You want me to talk shit to you on a DM so that you can repost it and put your response.
Right.
Like, I don't want to do that, man. Like, that's not what this is about.
Maybe the best thing moving forward is just not talking about it anymore. Yeah. Just keep worrying about ourselves, doing what we're doing.
Man, my goal is...
At the end of the day, we're happy. That's all that matters.
Yeah, I'm happy, but, you know, I feel I owe it to the industry to do my best to help people...
Figure it out.
Just get out and ride, man. Just get out and be a part of it and find the love for motorcycles like I did. And sometimes... people aren't going to agree with the way I do it or what I say or how I feel. And honestly, the point is about having a real conversation is that I was hoping that this dude could change my mind. And he didn't want to take the chance to change my mind.
Good luck, dude. It's not lost cause. Yeah.
But yeah, at the end of the day, that's all, you know, fuck it. It is what it is. But it's, you know, moving forward, like, you know, I was really thinking, like, I don't know what to do with this bike. I don't, you know, like, same thing after I finished my gold FXR, man. Like, you know, you look at this project that you finished and you kind of exhausted a lot of your ideas or your wants, you know, because sometimes I think a project has a little bit of what you're inspired to do, but sometimes there's just like, I want this bike for this reason. Mm-hmm. And I want to feel this out, like.
Well, what's funny about it to me is you took the same bike and replaced it with the same bike.
Yeah, yeah, 100%.
For the most part. We won't get into the details between 18 and 20 or 19 and 20 and all that, but you have the same bike again. So when I seen it, I'm like, fuck is this dude doing right now? Like, he's so far in. Why start over? Right.
Yeah.
As a builder, why start over?
Well, because the other option with my current or my last Road Glide was going to be sell these tins and repaint it, redo a new paint job.
Because you're sick of it?
No, because, well, another thing about doing marketing is that, like, I have to keep my bikes different because when I travel, if you got 100 pictures of my bike at...
The same bike. Right.
At the same place across the country, it doesn't resonate with people the same way as if you... And most people, you know, most people would build bikes and sell them, and that'd be the thing, right? But... because I ride them so much and I put miles on them, it's hard to kind of get what you need out of it.
Right.
Rather than just redoing it over and over and over again. You know, like I've never really been in the market of selling bikes. I've always been in the market of riding them. And so this opportunity came up. The market's hot as fuck to sell bikes right now.
True.
And so, you know, I hinted at it. Someone he bit. Like I said, we talked about the guy earlier. And it does feel weird to make a lateral move for the most part in one form or fashion as far as the same bike, but I mean there's just no other bike to me that performs that way and that I'm comfortable on and I kind of don't see myself not having. So that Road Glide was just another option. Now I like I said earlier, I do want to try, I want to set it up a little different than I'm used to and see it how it feels and see if I like it differently. But I mean
we really got to get you on a Challenger.
It gets weird. It gets exhausting when people just, you know, think that it's like some kind of real hate. Like, I don't have a problem with the bikes, but
look,
I just don't care.
We're hanging out tomorrow. We're doing some shit. Mm-hmm. Good chance for you.
I'll ride it.
Good opportunity for you.
And
to
you
ride.
Can video and tag me and everything. I have no problem with
it's
that.
It's not about poking fun and saying, hey, look at this hypocrite. Look at this. Jace is going against everything he's ever said. I think that you take me as a good example from a guy that built a Harley who's kind of got it all to a guy who opened his mind and said, all right, let's try this, and is very happy with it. I think that speaks volumes. It really does.
So the one thing that's different between myself and I think some people, and I wouldn't say it's different from you, but maybe not, you're not on this kind of level. There's something about the brand of Harley that I'm connected with.
Just the diehard.
Yeah, it's.
I get that. I do. I would say that I am that way. Yeah. I am. But I think that what happened is I put so much time and money and effort into my personal Harley to get it to a point where I'm very happy with it. It's fantastic. Awesome bike. But the money side of it always weighs on you. So it's like, fuck, man, I had to put that much into it to be like genuinely satisfied with it.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking the mustard version. I'm talking version one.
Yeah.
Was a sick ass bike. Most people love to own that bike. Stock chassis, just an inverted front end, aluminum swing arm, blah, 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 blah. But even that bike was comparable to a stock Challenger.
Yeah.
So it's like, man, for what I put into it, to what a dollar for dollar, let's not kid ourselves, money is the root of all evil.
Mm-hmm.
It always is. So for the bang for the buck, it's such a killer bike. And I get it. There's some plastic shit. You can't get over it.
What I have a hard time getting over is the fact that you are currently trying to build a business on being creative and taking something that's boring and make it badass.
Yeah.
And so the whole point of buying something like a Harley or anything in the custom world is about making it your own. So it's not a, you know, like if you're a car guy and you got a fucking 67 Chevelle or whatever the fuck,
right,
comparable to a new anything, like it's so much better and it's cheaper. Why do that?
But it's,
there's something different when you're cruising down the street in a 67 Chevelle.
Agreed, but completely wrong. 67 Chevelle versus brand new Camaro is irrelevant.
Okay.
We're talking brand new Indian versus brand new Harley. It's apples for apples at that point.
At that point, yeah.
It is. So I'm just trying to get people to open their minds and say, look, we don't have to join the masses. We don't have to do... Here's my thing.
So you do know that Indian burned, or no, Polaris burned a lot of industry when they got rid of the last brand, right? They fucked a lot of people over. A lot of people don't want to make products for a brand that they don't think is going to ride out the wave long enough.
I understand.
So Indian has to put 5 years in of their brand, which right now they're only like three in, realistically, four.
Right. But if you look at not that I'm like a professional in the history of this, but if you look at the revamp of Indian / Polaris,
yeah,
there's never been anything like this.
True.
You look back to early 2000s with the Indians back then, it was an Indian. It looked like an Indian, but it was a pretty much a piece of shit.
Yeah.
And then it died again, and now it's back, and they have really revamped.
True.
Now, the weird thing about that to me is to sit and pump up a brand like that, Polaris / Indian, it honestly to me feels like I could equally pump up Yamaha, BMW, Suzuki.
Yeah.
That's weird to me because I didn't grow up on a motorcycle. I don't have my favorite dirt bike. I'm just going with the flow, right?
Yeah.
So that's not where this is coming from. It's just being... And maybe that's what's helpful is being somewhat of an outsider, a guy with talent with his two fucking hands who can make shit cool, coming from trucks to cars to now bikes, saying, hey, look, there's this other product that is superior.
And yeah, 100%.
And y'all don't have to put 20 G's into it to make it perform the same way as your Harley does. That's all I'm saying. And so that's why I bought into it. And I really am having the time of my life. I mean, the motor's out of the Road King right now. It is sitting there.
Yeah.
I just need the time of day to get it back on the road. And I will be excited to ride it again. I will be. I rode Mark's bike a couple weeks ago. And I said to myself, God damn, this is a bad motherfucker. I mean, the suspension, the Dark Horse bottom end, it was a beast.
Yeah.
But there wasn't anything about it that said, this is so much better than the Challenger. Nothing about that said that.
You know, so, without discrediting, like, first off, like, the Indian's a great bike, and it's a great option for people that want to go that route. They're looking for the bang for the buck, right? 100%. Not saying that. And anybody that's saying, like, well, if you make passion purchases,
right,
completely based on financial things, then you're missing the point.
But that's where I'm coming from as a guy who has
If you plan on buying two bikes and you don't plan to put money into them, mm-hmm, for sure. And you don't care about any of the other reasons.
But take it from a dude with that Harley sitting right there.
No matter what, if they want what your Harley sitting right there, they have to spend thousands of dollars.
Right.
It doesn't change. The same parts that you're buying to put in on this bike is...
So that's where I'm struggling when you bring up starting a new business, new shop, what are you going to be doing, that kind of thing.
I said it earlier. I thought it was great that you did that because you're wired into where you look at this as a challenge, right?
Right.
And that's cool. That's what that bike needs is people to look at it with that idea.
Mm-hmm.
That ain't me. I don't give a shit. Right. And I'm not trying to be that guy and I don't care. Now, the joke is that FXR Mike made it a joke, and then, you know, Adam Sandoval came on the podcast, asked if I'd paint one, and I was like, fuck no, I ain't painting one of those bikes.
Right.
It was a joke.
Right.
I don't care to, but if you were building that bike and you would ask me, yes, for you or someone building a real bike like that, right, yeah, I'd be down. I'd be honored to be a part of it. So but,
baby steps is what we're talking right now.
I think that, like, people need to stop looking at this in that it's not black and white, and everybody's trying to make it black and white.
Right.
Right. Buying this bike over that bike is not, well, this bike has more horsepower. I was like, well, then fucking go buy a BMW, bro.
Right.
Go buy any other metric bike, right?
Hey,
I buy a Harley because I'm a Harley guy.
And I'll be the first to admit that. If you want something that's just balls out amazing, go get a Goldwing.
Yeah.
Go get a BMW.
Yeah.
I agree completely. I'm just doing the best with what I can, with what it is, and I'm having a good time.
Yeah, and that's what's supposed to happen.
But moving forward, and this circles all the way back to the beginning of this podcast, moving forward, I don't know where to reach to continue to produce with the newest, the best, the coolest. You know what I'm saying? Like, whether it's a touring bike, a soft tail, whatever. It's been done so many times, mm-hmm, that's what intrigues me with the Indian. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's what keeps my flame going, yeah, if that makes sense. It's just, there's just not enough of it to where it's going to stay intriguing. Where you name it, we've seen it.
I get it. You know, so, but at the same time, if you were building an old school ride of some sort, whether it's this or that, like, I mean, say you had to build a, you know, what was it, a 59 Cadillac?
Right.
Yep. What if you had to build 40 of those?
Yeah, I mean, you couldn't because they don't exist.
Exactly. So,
but aside from that, even then, there's still select few that if you dream it, it's been done.
Yeah.
Right? And so for creative minds like ourselves, it's continuing to push the envelope like that. You know, there's always someone who's done it before you, even if you don't know of it. Or
I look at this stuff simply, like, the reason I got that new bike is because as the guy that rides bikes, I wanted another Road Glide, mm-hmm, right? Not the Fast Life Garage or whatever. I just, Jay Sutton, wanted another Road Glide because I love Road Glides, right?
Right.
And now I own one. I don't have a note on it. And I'm fucking, that was a big reason. Like, I own a brand new Road Glide.
Did you still have payments on the last one?
I did, yeah.
So, big congrats on that.
Mm-hmm.
Hell yeah. When I bought the Road King, I paid cash for it. I've never felt better.
Yeah. So, it's like, I wanted to own the bike. And, you know, to me, it's, like I said, I still think that paint-wise, there's still a lot of uncharted waters with the performance bagger scene, right? Mm-hmm. And so, I want to try to do this one with the same, you know, satisfaction I got on my last paint job, but new. But also, I want to ride this one. I'm going to, you know, Sturgis, I'm doing Daytona, and me and the boys are going to Pacific Northwest next year. I'm going to do Sturgis again. And maybe, since I don't have to worry about making a payment, I'll sell this one after Sturgis next year. and I'll do another one.
I think you kind of set your own bar a little too high with the last one.
I hope not.
Honestly, dude, like, I know you have like mostly bolt-on stuff with a really cool paint job, but it's going to be tough to top that again.
You know, I've always envied you because when the bikes that you have put out, like your Road King, like I said, I always say this with a grain of salt because my FXR was that level of my skill, right? Mm-hmm. Yep. And yours is what it is.
Right.
But my FXR exposed me to really, really want to travel. I had done cross-country trips on my big wheels and even my Dyna before the FXR, but the FXR was like, yo, this is what I'm fucking doing now.
Right.
And since then, it's been hard for me to want to do a frame off because, you know, I'm...
The commitment. The bang for the buck, even if you're not going to like weld up all the holes that you don't need,
yeah,
run the brake lines inside of the frame rails, the clutch line, the wiring and all that, it helps to have like a cleaned up neck to where it's super clean.
Yeah.
But even if you just unbolt it, powder coat the chassis a different color, put it back together. Like, don't modify anything. Just powder coat the chassis. Huge bang for the buck.
And the only reason I didn't do it on the last one is because I wasn't satisfied with the last paint job. And I knew I wanted to change it. So I felt like if I did a color.
Well, you're just clearly never going to be happy.
Well, I also. So I wanted to find a way to make an impactful bike that didn't have to go to that level. And I felt like I did with that one. You know, used a black bike,
yeah,
stock parts.
You did. The paint job was tremendous, but the chassis, it's kind of just the level of detail.
It is.
When a guy goes through every single bolt on a bike,
mm-hmm,
it shows.
It definitely does.
It pays off in the long run. So, but at the end of the day, it's such a catch-22 because when you're talking about riding these things, how much does it really matter? What is that extra couple of G's? What's that going to gain you? You know, unless you're chasing trophies. I don't know. I came from a mindset of like winning shows and being top dog to building bikes. And then with building the bikes, it's like, well, I still want to go to the same level. And it's even easier on a bike than it is a car. But then the more I ride them, the more I kind of don't really care.
Yeah.
Case in point, I plan on doing all new hardware on the Challenger. I've done the key hardware, shit that really jumps out at you, but the rest of it's stock. I plan on changing all of it, but right now, I don't give a shit about it because that bike is ready to fire, ready to go, anywhere, anytime. So,
same thing with the Road Glide I had, man.
I understand that. So it's like you and I, we're kind of finding this tough balance of show and go.
Yeah.
But you got to have the show because it really rides on your back of who you are and what you do and how you make your money. And it's a weird balance, but there's honestly never been a better time to do it. Like,
mm-hmm,
now is awesome. Everything is, for where we've come from and where we're at, everything's awesome and everybody's cool and everyone's having a good time. And I would rather focus on that and just stay positive and keep moving forward. Honestly, I think now that I have you face to face, I think it's bullshit we haven't done a road trip together. It's time.
I want to do a road trip with all the homies that haven't ridden to Cali yet, and I want to do one with them.
Okay, so I've ridden Cali. I've done PCH, San Fran to LA.
Steve hasn't. Craig hasn't.
Yep.
Fucking Jetty hasn't.
So let's not go nuts over like 10. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm in. Let's go.
Yeah.
That's what the bike, the Indian's sitting there. It's ready to go. I know what I'm missing out on PCH, and
it's not so much that there's so much in between.
It's so much fun. I mean, when I did PCH, I broke off into just north of Santa Cruz,
mm-hmm,
killer mountains up there. Awesome riding. And then just north of Ventura, I went up to where like James Dean crashed his Porsche. And then into San, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it was San Anglio, mm-hmm, Forest. Fucking awesome riding up there too. So I got like all of the fucking ocean plus the mountains / desert. And then up in Santa Cruz, you got like
the big trees and all that shit.
You got borderline like redwoods / pine trees,
mm-hmm,
there's so much to offer up there. Absolutely.
Yeah, I rode Caramel, however you say it, Valley.
Yeah, like...
last time it was pretty awesome.
Yeah, like Caramel by the Sea?
Yeah, so before that...
that's like...
So I went up and I went through the James Dean part like you were talking about. Mm-hmm. I actually missed the fucking statue monument for him.
Oh, really?
But I've driven the highway before. I never rode it, so I rode it this time.
Right. Still counts.
Yeah, and then I basically... there's a... you can go through the Caramel Valley...
so that's like
drops you off right at Laguna Seca, and then
yeah, like jump. Pebble Beach yeah. and Laguna Seca and all that. So
dude, it was fucking beautiful. Not the best roads ever, but it's real slow, so you're able to kind of avoid a lot of things. But it's
just something to take in.
Yeah,
like something you've never experienced before. We definitely need to do that. Like get the homies together.
Like I said, I love that all you guys are doing the Smokies, but mm-hmm. it's like it's low hanging fruit, bro. It's down the street.
I understand.
When you earn these like big trips and you're standing, yeah. like when, like, let's put it like this. When we all made it to the lighthouse, which is very underwhelming, by the way.
In Maine.
In Maine.
Yep.
You know.
Underwhelming.
Yeah. It's like a very, it's a short, stubby, you know.
Right.
Lighthouse compared to the ones that you would normally see.
Right.
But the sense of accomplishment that we all had standing there is like, fuck, man. Like. No matter what, you did it, and you did it with your boys, and now we've done it coast to coast together, not in one run, but,
right.
you know, it's like there's something to that. And so when you just meet up at a spot and you all party, great time. That's the camp out, right? Mm-hmm. It really is.
Right.
But I've always said this, the people that travel to the camp out have a different bond with the people they rode with.
I agree completely. Even this year coming down, I took a group. It wasn't just me solely, but... I pretty much created a ride to the camp out
mm-hmm.
and I very quickly brought on Chris, KZ Eliminator, because yeah. he's a great tour guide. Him and I are very good at navigation, keeping groups together. It's just something that we have. So him and I, we got this group together. There was literally 20 of us yeah. and we're like, all right, we met at Starbucks. Okay. So we're at Starbucks and we're like, all right, raise your hand if you want to go the fast way, raise your hand if you want to go the fucking cool way. And there was like two or three hands that said fast. And I'm like, all right, sorry about y'all. We'll see you there. We're going this way. If y'all want to come with, let's go. And those two or three, they stuck to their ways. They went the fast way.
Mm-hmm.
They got there. I don't know what time. It was definitely quicker than us.
Yeah.
Because we now had 17 bikes and we're going 2-lane highway through some very awesome riding in Missouri, which mm-hmm. exists. I want to take you to some of it someday because it's fucking way better than you would imagine.
Yeah.
We took the scenic route, fucking went through Little Rock, dipped down to Hot Springs, headed west. What time we show up? Like 12, 1 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
And even though the other three homies beat us there, wouldn't change it for anything.
Yeah.
I mean, we had an awesome fucking day. Nobody wrecked. Nobody broke down. We showed up. Everybody was equally excited to see us. I mean, it was pitch dark and I'm like, who the fuck is this? Everyone's high-fiving me.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So... and that's just what it's all about. And then the camp out, like, we barely rode, dude. Like, we went and rode Talamina. It was foggy as shit. Horrible riding. Shitty day to ride. I've ridden Talamina. It's great when the weather allows.
Yeah.
That day, weather didn't allow it. So that weekend was not about riding at all. It was mm-hmm. about the trip there and hanging out with people.
That was...
I'll never miss another one. I mean, it was my first one. It was fucking amazing.
That was like the weather this year was unique. It never, the whole country was, this whole year has been weird.
It was a weird time. Yeah. Cause like a day or two before when we left that morning from St. Louis, I put on the heated gear.
Yeah.
It was 25 degrees when we left my house. Thank God I bought that heated gear. I bought it earlier that week.
Yeah.
I've never had it before completely in the same way.
Rain gear.
Which, by the way, you bought rain gear today after 100,000 miles.
Because what happened is I've had nothing but great. Usually when I get caught in the rain, it's like a quick storm and you pass through and you're done, right? And you dry off. Well, I didn't talk about it too much, and now karma's done bit me in the ass. Okay. Because I've been getting caught in gnarly-ass rainstorms for the last year and a half.
Yeah.
To the point where it would stop me in my tracks a couple times.
There's no coming back from rain gear. It's fantastic. Equally, I know you live in Texas, but a little further north, equally heated gear. Dude, I would say I went from I'm not going to say fair weather rider, but, you know, if it ain't 50 or 60, I'm cool.
Yeah.
You know, with heated gear, a fucking game on, dude. Like, you name it. As long as there's not ice on the road, let's go.
Yeah.
It is that fantastic. So, also a part of where I think we're headed with BMWs and Cold Wings. It's like the yellow vests are coming.
Well, ultimately, you know, eventually me and my close friends, like, we want to do some, like, you know, Canada and things like that. And even in the summertime.
Hey, Chris, KZ Eliminator, mm-hmm. me and Chris, he did Europe last year.
Mm-hmm.
Super jealous, okay? But super expensive.
Yeah.
Him and I, our next big goal as adults and motorcycle enthusiasts, we're doing Alaska.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And so we're riding through Canada. We're going to start where we live, go through Canada, go to Alaska.
Yeah.
And we're going to fucking battle the bears. And you can't bring a gun into Canada.
Yeah.
But as soon as you cross from Canada to Alaska, you can buy a gun right at the border. Like, to protect yourself from fucking bears, right? Yeah. We're working towards that, okay? So that's what we're heading towards. Uh-huh. Now, I'm just ashamed that I don't have the mileage under my belt that dudes like yourself, Steve, numerous other guys.
Dude.
We don't have those amountage of mileage, but that's what we're working towards. And so,
at the end of the day, it's not really about like.
Well, it's not a number.
My homies at Tulane Life, those dudes, you know, they're trading in their bikes now because they're a year old and they got 70,000 miles on it, right?
Right. It's not a specific number.
It's just about, like, you do it. Like,
but dude, it's the.
Maybe it's just from here to Oklahoma. Maybe it's from here to Talamina. Right.
But it's a passion thing. It's so inspiring is what it is. I mean, it truly is. Look at the shop, man. I mean, you got this place that you're calling like a playground, like a dream. Why do you think that I've gotten to this point? I mean, it's meeting dudes like you and inspiring to, I'm going to take this shop that I'm painting bikes in and I'm building a fucking studio in it.
You
know, it's like just goals to just keep progressing and feeding each other to where we can just continue and continue. And I don't know what the end game is, but clearly we're onto something.
Dude, the end game, there's no way to know where this path leads everybody.
Right.
It's just about being open-minded and seeing what comes available, right? Yep. The friends that come around, you know, and those friends bring in new opportunities and new perspectives. So mm-hmm. you got to be fluid enough to accept new ideas in your life. And dude, like, you know, the podcast has shaped me into a different person.
Right.
Just talking with everybody.
Yep.
It's
the same way with camping. I legitimately hate camping, but to get out and get out on the bike and travel, I'm willing to do it because I would rather a hotel.
Yeah.
But if it come push comes to shove, like, I'm
this
in.
Trip we just did to Maine, it we missed the camping, right?
You really think so?
Yeah, I know. So a lot of us, we didn't really talk about it on the podcast, but there's certain places, like when you're in New York, you want to do New York shit, right?
Sure.
You're not camping there.
Sure.
Right? But you kind of, on certain trips, you need that balance of city and off the beaten path.
Yeah.
And we didn't really have enough of the nature on this trip to kind of balance out how many cities we were in.
Yeah.
And so it kind of, like I said, I feel personally like we didn't do the East the kind of justice because we had never done it before. I had ridden to Cali five times before me and these homies ever went out there.
But you crossed off all those big ticket items that you need to just get off the list.
I could go to New York. I could do it right now. I love that city. Being in New York is like being in LA. It's just, I come alive and I feel like I'm connected to the Matrix or something like that, you know? Same thing, I didn't really get to spend a lot of time in Chicago when I came through last time, but I got a feeling I would kind of have that vibe too, because where we were hanging out with DA, it kind of had that kind of alive feeling. But
taken from someone who lived 10 years in Illinois.
Yeah.
Like, Chicago has that feel. It does, but it is not a good place. So, it's just not, dude. The only reason I still stay positive about Chicago is because of Chris.
Yeah.
KZ Eliminator. That is it. That place is so bad. It's not even good.
There's just a lot. There's a lot to do. You know, the camping, you know, when you go to these really amazing places, these nature type places, like being, you know, grabbing a 12 pack and going and sitting by a fire and, you know, with it's, you can't replace that.
Right.
And some of the shit you talk, not shit you talk to each other, but the things that you say to each other might be the thing that you're finding yourself doing with them the next year. Right.
Right.
You're sitting at a campground in Yellowstone. You're talking about, man, let's go to the lighthouse next year. And then bam, you're standing there. You know,
have you done, you've never done Lake Michigan, right? Like the tour?
I haven't done around it. Just, okay. I rode my bike onto a boat and it went across it.
Yeah. You went up to Milwaukee. You've been up to Grand Rapids. You've been across. So what's cool is you go up all the way up and around to Mackinac Bridge, Mackinac Island, but also up to Lake Superior. Mm-hmm. Super cool place. Put it on your to-do list.
That is one of them, because as my core group of dudes I travel with, we haven't done any of these states up here together.
Right.
So even though I did it last year and I'm doing some of it now, I know eventually we're going to make like a short trip, like a 9-day trip out of it, just coming up and doing the loop and knocking off all these states. Because our goal as friends is to do all 50 or all 48 together.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
Yep. And, well, you can definitely count me and Chris in on that. I guarantee you for that. He's done it numerous times. I've done it once.
Yeah.
It's a good time.
It sucks because like doing like the up north camp, I would be the perfect time for it. But it's just as an industry guy, it's just so close to Sturgis.
Yeah, getting shit done with Sturgis. So.
You know, because technically that's going on in what, 2 weeks? No, like next weekend, you know?
Yeah. Well, I'll be up there with Monty Roach again.
The camp out, Sturgis, you'll be at Sturgis, yeah.
The camp out is in a week, but I got to be up in Sturgis by like the 29th.
Yeah, so that's right. I'll get there.
I'm going to be there in like 2 weeks. Sturgis for me is like 3 weeks long because I work with Monty. So, that's coming up here. But other than that,
this year, like after Sturgis, like we got a family thing that we're doing, or me and my wife doing one thing. I'm probably going to drive to California just to do podcasts with some people and stop in Phoenix.
Gotcha.
I'll do the down south camp out because it's kind of like the end of the year thing.
So I am putting that on my to-do list.
Yeah, it's a good time, man.
Yeah, riding down there.
And then after that, man, like it's kind of like I want to kind of, like you said, put your nose to the grindstone. And I just want to like bang out some very... I want to take in a couple projects that are going to be that thing that go to Daytona and things like that. That like I want to like put my work out there a little bit more.
It seems like you have a project sitting right next to
us. Well, yeah, I'll do that, but I want to do...
The 2020 Road Glide.
Yeah.
That's going to be more than work than you think it is.
No, it's not. Do it in a week.
I like it. A week. That's impressive. Are you going to do the frame on it?
I don't think so.
You did the frame on the FXR, right?
Yeah.
You should.
The FXR was completely Cerakoted motor, tranny, primary, all that.
Yeah.
Frame.
I think it's time. I think you're due.
Yeah, I don't know.
You've done some shit since then. I didn't know you when you did the FXR or the Dyna, but I seen your white...
bagger, yeah.
Yeah.
The big wheel? Or no, the other white
not
performance
the big
bagger.
Wheel. Yeah.
That was just a paint job, though. It wasn't like frame off or anything.
Right, but you had wheels, you had a pipe. Yeah. Did you have a Royal T pipe on that bike?
It was kind of like our version of a knockoff.
Okay.
No, it was my buddy Carlos made it, and I helped. He was teaching me how to TIG weld, okay. So
but
I was there kind of helping him.
But it was a white Road Glide. You painted it. And I was at a bar. I was in California for Born Free, and I seen that bike sitting there, and I'm like, holy shit. It's
so
the
you saw
Fast it. Life Garage.
You saw
so
the guy that bought it.
I send you a message, and you're like, oh, no, dude, I sold it. And I'm like, oh, motherfucker, I was trying to meet you.
Yeah.
This was like 3 years ago. So that is inspiration right there. That's what I'm saying. Like, you got to keep fucking feeding off that shit. you haven't done anything like that since then. It's time for a frame off.
Yeah,
it's been time. A minute. Dude, you don't have to go nuts. Just fucking. The problem is that when you go frame
off, everything else stands out.
Oh, sorry. It all stands out.
Yeah.
I understand that. But listen, it ain't nothing but a fucking hardware kit from Santoro. Holler at your boy.
Yeah.
All right. And you just, it's nuts and bolts. You pull it apart, you coat the chassis, you bolt it back together.
Yeah.
It's absolutely bang for the buck. I think you're overdue.
Yeah.
From a friend to a friend, it's time.
If I can come up with a paint scheme and a color combination that I'm just completely jazzed about.
Yeah. You'll get there.
Then I think that you it got would what be. It
takes.
I just there's still a lot of I don't know. There's still a lot. I mean, I put a lot of work, and then I just, you know, I do want to sell this bike at the end of next year, so I don't know. Sometimes when you do that I know,
but your hours don't cost you anything. Even if you could be making up the hours on customers' work, believe me, I get it.
Well, yeah, like I said, that's kind of the goal. Is I want to do more bikes. I've been kind of slacking on wanting to take in bikes, but also I travel a lot and I don't want to have anybody's project sitting on the floor and paint Joe, like you say.
Right. So do you have more plans for podcasts? Bigger? More?
Well,
I don't mean to say better, but bigger names, more podcasts, more traveling?
Well, the thing is, the bigger names, like the, I guess, celebrities, if you will.
Sure.
Like, that only happens as this thing continues to grow. So as it continues to grow and you have the back end, which is the listenership,
to get them on board.
Yeah, okay. Exactly. So it makes sense when you, I mean, don't get us wrong. Like, you know, the podcast is well in where in its space, but its space isn't that big. You know what I mean?
Sure.
So,
but it's getting there. It's growing.
Yeah. Like I said, I'm stoked about it, but you know, I mean, obviously we're still trying to make the podcast better as far as videos form. So we're working on another camera angle. And that should just cost money and time.
Sure.
And, you know, trying to add some more things to the studio so that when we do the camera angle, you have another, like, something more to look at than just someone's face, if you will.
I really think that the content is more important than the video
portion. It is. But the video portion adds a layer to it because, trust me, I never gave a shit about video podcasts. I didn't. But, like you have that TV in there now. Mm-hmm. When I started watching Rogan on the video, I enjoyed it more, and now I don't like listening to the audio versions.
Without the TV version.
Exactly, because okay. I sit there at the desk working on tanks or whatever all day long.
So you're listening all day, but when you peek up, it's there.
Yeah.
Okay, I get
so that. So it gives you that chance, like if they start talking about something, you know they're going to pull up something that's relative to it. So you can see it.
Oh, sure, yeah.
There's just, you get the nuances of a conversation, like
that makes sense.
Smile, the way their face looks.
Yeah.
And it's not that I'm staring at it like I'm watching a TV show.
Right.
It's just, it helps. So.
That's where I've struggled with the TV in the shop thing is like.
It just depends. Like if you're walking all over the place, it's not going to work. But right. I work at a bench for the most part. Yeah, so
I get it.
Yeah, I mean. The whole world seems to be going video. So even if the podcast video side isn't like the most, I think what people are seeming to like is being a part of the live thing because we do a little bit of interacting. We try not to do too much of it, but it does become like we're all sitting in a room together. It's just some people have the pass to talk and, you know, other people don't.
To be able to ask the question or hope that their question gets answered.
Sometimes they do.
Yeah.
If they're relative, you know.
Have you noticed the numbers pumping up?
Oh, yeah. I mean, not that these are big numbers in the world of live stream. Last
time was like 79 or something like
that. Yeah, I mean, there was a point in time where like the Steve Chamberlain one we just did had like over 89 viewers at one time.
And well, then, that's because Steve is awesome.
Yeah, he is. But yeah, our podcast still, the audio side is where people mostly take.
Yep.
You know, that's where a lot of our numbers come from things like that.
Admittedly, homeboy, like I've been Patreon for well over a year now.
Thanks.
And it ain't a dollar. It's like 10 bucks a month.
Woo!
Because I love you.
Thanks for the road glide.
Yes, you're welcome. I've never listened to one Patreon episode ever.
Dude, there's some good ones on there, dude.
I honestly think that I've heard enough to where when it starts getting too drunk, you cut to Patreon, and then I'm like,
we've done.
I don't need to handle more drunkenness.
So we've kind of chilled on a lot of those ones, right?
Really?
So the ones that are really good are, we've done quite a few that are just us. Like, we just show up and we do a podcast only on Patreon.
Okay.
And though, like, we did one with Craig that was funny as fuck.
So I kind of view that as, like, yeah. as someone who's listened to literally, like, I've listened to every podcast now.
Mm-hmm.
Check my phone. They're all checked. I look forward to them coming out. Okay. But sometimes I'll wait for like 3 or 4 to come out
yeah. and
bang them out in like 2 days nonstop. Right.
Mm-hmm.
But then for the Patreon, I almost view that as like, all right, well, there's going to be a moment where I can just bang out like weeks worth of Patreon, yeah. but it's not up to the moment. So yeah, it's a yeah. bit weird.
Yeah. Sometimes that's the but only
like
thing
I follow that shit. I stay up on the times, so I should be able to like, kind of stay relevant to it, you know?
That's the only thing that sucks about sometimes, like when we talk on the podcast, there's so much going on in our scene
mm-hmm.
that things tend to be about what's going on in the now.
Right.
A lot of times, especially when it's just the homies on there.
Right.
And, you know, crazy enough, man, like when like Dragon and my buddy James and Big Will Cody on, those are some of the biggest number podcasts we get.
Yeah.
You know
well,
what I mean?
You know, with,
compared, and you would think it'd be like the, you know, don't get me wrong, the Nest podcast did a lot, but.
You know, with the Texas boys, you kind of get like, I don't know, like with the Texas boys, it gets to be a bit repetitive, but yeah. it's very passionate. Yeah. So even though it's, you've heard the same thing over and over again.
It's because we're drunk and we forget we talked about
it. I understand that, but you always appreciate it. Like,
yeah.
I don't know, it just has more of like a kind of like hometown kind of feel to it. Like, you can start to relate to Big Will Cody B.
Yeah.
Who, like, at first, I didn't know who he was. But in the last year, I've got to know him, and Jesus, that guy's awesome. Like,
yeah.
Daytona this year, he was like, yeah, you know, I did Key West by myself. And I'm like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
What are you talking about? And you just kind of like, I don't know, man. You got to put yourself out there. The digger you deep, the more you get to know these guys. Yeah. And it gets really cool.
The thing is, like, when the pandemic hit last year, I realized that, you know, getting these guys comfortable on a podcast all gives us the reason I can always have somebody on, because right. these guys are my closest friends. Right. And if we can get on a podcast and talk and it's something people care about, then maybe we can't do it every week. But say a pandemic or something happens where we just can't get new guests on, at least we can have that. You know what I mean?
Right.
And not saying they're like a fucking last resort, but in a sense, it's like those dudes help me do so much, whether it's the camp out, or stay sane and be a biker and hang out and ride yeah. or do these podcasts or whatever I do. These guys are my biggest supporters and I try to be their biggest supporters.
Yeah. It's, I mean, I've noticed that, and just coming up on those similarities with people like FXR/Goldwing Mike and yeah. Just Steve, and just seeing some of the familiar faces, you almost, I know these people face to face. I have a relationship with them.
Yeah.
But even if I didn't, I would feel like I would, because I've heard them at that date and then heard them 3 months later. And
yeah.
that, you know, the way that it continues, you almost like hear and feel these people progress in life. And
you get to watch it all take place.
Yeah, I mean, and it makes sense. It does. And so that's a cool thing to bank on. And then, of course, you eventually just run out of people to interview
until you run out. Consistently.
Yeah, yeah. You know what consistently, I mean? Right.
And so that's the one thing that's the only reason why our podcast probably does so well, is because it happens every month.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I guess it's time for the stunt riders, huh?
Yeah. I guess. Do we have anybody else? Nobody else? Okay, come on, Steve. I mean, there's still other areas I'd like to get into. I mean, you know, but it's all about, I mean, even photography, I love that right now. And there's a lot of motorcycle-based photographers, but I still got to be careful, because you can't do...
That's a tough one. I love John Jackson stuff, because I've known him for 15 years. But I can only sit and listen to so much photography conversation. So I get that.
You got to, even like I said, I can't make every podcast for everybody, but I got to make podcasts that bring if this one out of five that I guarantee I'm putting out every month, mm-hmm. if this one isn't for you, the other four might be, hopefully.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right. I get
But
that.
This one, I need this one because that's something I'm interested in. And hopefully some other people that are interested will find something from it. You know what I mean?
Right.
And, you know, it's the same way when you talk about FXRs or performance baggers or stunt riding. There's all these genres within this world of motorcycles that I have to try to talk about. People used to, I mean, I used to get a lot of people that said they didn't like the paint episodes. You know what I mean? A lot of people.
Gotcha.
You know, and I'm like, well, shit, man. Like, I'm a fucking painter.
So I extremely enjoyed all of those episodes.
Yeah.
Coming from a paint background. It was awesome to hear other people, other painters.
And I want to bring more painters on too, but it's kind of one of those weird things where
I get that.
Where I mean, I have no problem. It's not a competition thing. I'll bring any painter on as long as we can have a conversation. Yeah. But
yeah,
you might gain painter listeners that want to hear this person specifically. But you know, like for instance, Steve Gibson, right? One of the baddest airbrush artists in the world. Nobody knows who he is.
Right.
And so we're on there talking fucking art theory and shit. Like, no one's fucking... The motorcycle world doesn't give a shit, right?
Right.
Painters did, which is awesome. And so I will always do those for those guys, you know? But...
Hearing Hot Dog was cool.
Dude, it was good to finally meet the guy.
Yeah. It was like, God damn, this dude is just like us.
Yeah.
Because you put him on such a pedestal.
Yeah.
You know? It's just like all the SEMA stuff with whatever, you know, Ryan from Counts Customs, Mike LaValle, all those dudes, like, you put them on these pedestals of the greatest.
Yeah.
And then you meet him in person, and you're like...
Just like us.
This dude ain't no different than me. Like,
yep.
Here you go. Here's a good one for you. Charles Armstrong.
Trust me. Me and Charles talk a lot.
Dude, he's so fucking cool. So down to earth. So talented. So experienced. Awesome dude to have on the podcast.
He's been wanting to come on for about 2 years now.
Yeah.
And he's just kind of elusive. Well, you know, sometimes
make it happen. But that's from like a painter's perspective on a painter's podcast. Most dudes are going to be like, ugh, fucking True Fire.
Yeah.
Blah, 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 blah. I mean, I get
that. The goal is if I do enough podcasts every month, then same thing. Rogan does between 5 and 10 podcasts a month. So if he does one with a scientist or someone that writes a children's book that you don't give two shits about, you don't have to worry about it. It isn't like you lost out on that one.
Do you listen to all of them?
No, I don't.
Okay. I've never listened to one ever.
For real?
Never.
This is good. He's got some really good podcasts.
Admittedly, I wouldn't know where to start because I would feel like I need to start at the best. How do you do that? And so I've literally only listened to your podcast. And Steve from Speakings, because he's amazing.
He's funny as shit. So I want to get him in the studio.
It's just you and him is the only ones I've listened to. So I have no leg to stand on.
There's a lot of great podcasts out there. Joe Rogan's amazing. There's a lot of really funny comedians that have great podcasts that are very, it's comedy, but there's so much relevance or however you would say that.
I get, yeah.
In like today's age and shit, but you know, the main goal is just to try to create engaging content and keep it growing and not do the same question. Cause I mean, dude, don't get me wrong. Like there's a lot of people that I haven't interviewed, but I'm not looking forward to going, so man, how'd you get into custom paint?
Right.
How'd you get into custom cars? Like that right. question gets old. And honestly, even though everybody's story is different, everybody tells the same story.
Yeah. I can
you
see
know what
that.
I mean?
Yep.
Because
I get it.
Some people will sit here and they'll fucking bullshit me for 3 hours. And some people, they've told me their life story in 15 minutes.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, yo, man, like, can I get the extended version? You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, I understand that.
And so then sometimes when you're expecting like, oh, man, I can't wait to hear about how this dude got into everything. And then you kind of like you start asking the questions and he's like they're going so quick through it. You're like, fuck, man. Been 15 minutes, we're already at 2021. You know, like,
right,
yeah, how did we get here this quick? You know, like, and so there's a lot of work. Not saying this is a hard job, but there's a lot of work in going to try to continue a conversation long enough right. to get real content out of it,
right? You know, like, what I mean? I could keep going for just hours and hours of I like the past, I like the how you got here and what you've done.
Covington's, that was one of my favorite ones. But hell, I've already spent a lot of time with that family.
Yeah, but you know what? That was some of my favorites too, especially Dave was good. hearing Jerry, but then hearing his wife chime in when she felt it was necessary. Yeah. It's fucking sweet, man. Cause it's like, I know Jerry and his wife. I've been working in Sturgis. I've known those dudes for a long time now. Mm-hmm. And it answers so many questions you've always had.
Yeah.
Listening to it. And it just gives you so much more respect for him.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Like, knowing that we're literally the same dude, he was just dealt the right cards. And that just depends on what your end game is or your goal is. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're trying to end rich as fuck or mass producing motorcycles or whatever your case is. But just hearing those different versions is so cool.
Yeah. And so, you know, you're literally trying to go around and first off, get an audience with as many of these people as possible. Mm-hmm. Also try to get audience with brands that are making parts to kind of give people like, hey, let's hear about this brand. Not this person, but this brand. Like, what do they do? What are they? But make it a conversation. You know what I mean? To where it's interesting. You know.
Yep.
But there's unlimited content, but you have to figure out how to turn it into content.
Well,
you know.
Kudos to you.
Thank you.
It's stressful.
It is.
I get it, man. I've literally listened to every single podcast. I stay up on it, and I support it as much as I can. And I don't envy you, not at all. I mean, it has got to be so much work to just not just get work done in general, painting, but then manage these people to try and get them together to schedule podcasts, do the traveling, pay the hotel stays to do it.
Yeah, dude. So like today, for instance.
Yeah, man. I mean, I know what fucking time you started looking at your clock over there. I know.
It was.
Dude, you're fucking 16 hours in right now. I'm so well aware.
8 a.m. at the airport.
Fucking A right. And what time landed is it?
At, shit, 2:45.
Two. It's almost 3 o'clock.
So it was exactly. A 2.5 hour flight to Milwaukee. Hopped on the. I did a photo shoot on a bike there. Signed the paperwork. Jumped on the bike. Did 220 miles out the gate.
Right.
Like stock ass bike, just fucking hustling. Went.
Let's and, get there.
And then, you know, made it here.
Took a giant dump.
Yeah, I did. Took a big dump.
Yep.
Yeah. And I actually almost did a little bit on myself.
Oh, on the that's road. Disgusting.
But I caught it though.
You're too young for that. You got to keep holding.
But so, tighter. But I mean, like, yeah, I got here at like 9:30.
I was you impressed know, with was, the time I you think made. It was
like 420 something miles or something I'm like that.
I'm disappointed in the peanut butter sandwich and the Ritz crackers that you've eaten.
Yeah.
I wanted to do more for you.
Dude.
But it just goes to show the dedication.
Yeah.
I wish you would stay tomorrow. I honestly need to get back. I really do. I want you to ride the Challenger.
I'm trying to go to bike night tomorrow night.
I want you to ride the Indian. I want you to hang out. I want you to just be my friend. But instead, you're trying to do T-Bar Tuesday, blah, blah, blah. So
I got to go to Rebels Inn and get a 3-hole change on this motherfucker. Then I got to go to bike night. Then I'm trying to, you know, get home, go to sleep. I got to do a helmet and I got to sketch 2 bikes and start on the bikes on Thursday.
All before Sturgis.
I got 2 bikes, a helmet, and possibly my bike, a solid color before Sturgis.
Right. And for all those motherfuckers that say it must be nice.
Yeah, it's still nice.
It's nice. But you know what? Yeah. Try harder, motherfucker. I'm not hearing that shit. So, are you ready to wrap it up?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, good.
Well, with that being said, I'm just one dude. I'm kind of special, but nothing special. you know, I got a lot.
Did you start a page for Forever Rad?
No, like I'm working towards it. The page, the name is taken, and I've been working towards trying to get it removed. Okay, like with Instagram.
Yeah.
Like it's a page that has 4 posts from 5 years ago. And I'm like, hey, y'all motherfuckers need to get rid of this thing so I can go legit.
Yeah.
And so.
Did you reach out to that page?
The page and Instagram. I've done it all.
Yeah.
And it's not going good. So I don't know what's going to happen. I can come up with some sort of form of
putting
underscores or whatever. And then using my InstaHeaven Kyle name as my actual name. So that if people search both ways, it'll bring it up.
Yeah.
Right. So I got that under control. But it's just been a matter of, I don't feel confident launching something that's going to say, hey, this is who I am. This is what I do. Because it's advertising for you to bring your shit to me, mm-hmm. which I'm cool with. I'm not ready for your shit. I'm booked till the end of the year. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm busy as fuck. I'm happy. I want to start riding more motorcycles. My number one goal is build bikes, ride bikes.
Yeah.
So it's all coming to fruition. I got Sturgis coming up. It's a 3-week trip. I got 4 more rallies to work this year. Another Tennessee trip. So I'm doing what I can. Things are building. I'm just trying to make this place as fantastic as possible. And then, all honesty, do you think I should do a camp out here? Before you fucking said it tonight,
yeah,
I was considering it. I've said it to other people, and I plan on asking you about it.
I think it'd be fun.
Do you think I should do it?
I would make it like an intimate type friend.
Invitation only.
Yeah.
Not open to the public. I got room.
Yeah.
But I don't got room for 300 motherfuckers.
Exactly.
Okay. So let's just go on record right now. We're doing a camp out here. I don't know when.
Okay.
But it's happening, whether it's towards the end of the year or next year. Yeah. I don't want to conflict with the Fast Life camp out, but I want to get all the Texas boys up here, Arkansas, Tennessee. I want to get
everybody in the circle.
Anybody in the circle, and let's fucking just throw a mass party. Fucking rager.
Yeah.
I got all the space.
Bring your skateboard.
We got ramps. I will beat you in a game of skate. I promise you. Homie still got it. Let's do it. But anyways, the future is exciting, and I couldn't do it without people like Jace. Thank you. And people like anybody who supports me. And, I'm just doing my best. Just trying to live that dream and ride motorcycles, build motorcycles. And by the way, we're going to be doing more Frenchies, more Bulldogs.
There you go.
So if you need a Frenchie, holler at your boy. We're going to expand that because we're going all out. We're buying it.
Secrets out. Joe Exotic of Frenchies?
Hey, secrets out. We're going to buy another puppy tomorrow.
Nice.
And she's like top notch. Like, we're going to start expanding, and we're going to start doing more Frenchies. Like, I can't help it. We love our French Bulldogs. So.
There you go.
Also, shout out to Yellow Wolf.
The creek water?
Because Yellow Wolf rides motorcycles. He employs my homie, Alex Heighton.
Yes, sir.
Get on. And he makes creek water, and we are very tipsy on some creek water right now. So shout out to Yellow Wolf. Hey, I promise I got a connection. I'm going to work on Yellow Wolf.
Alex is a homie. I rode with him.
Dude, I've known Alex for 10 years. Yeah. I fucking love that kid. He's amazing.
Yeah.
I have the in. Let's talk to Alex. We will get Yellow Wolf.
Cool.
I got you, bro.
All right. Thanks, Kyle.
Okay. Thank you.
I really hope you guys enjoyed that. I always have a great time talking with Kyle. He's a very inspiring guy to myself, and I'm glad to call him a friend. You know, I really have enjoyed knowing this guy over the years, and I'm hoping that you guys get to, see his work for many years to come, because it's going to leave a mark on our industry, in my opinion. So, yeah, thank you guys, man. I appreciate you checking out this podcast. We got a couple more coming this month before we hit Sturgis. If you've been skipping through our ads, you might want to check them out. You know, we dropped a little bit of knowledge of where some of these brands are going to be at Sturgis, and you might want to check it out. And it might be a good opportunity for you to support this podcast by stopping in and seeing these people in Sturgis in person. So as always, man, the sponsors, the Patreon, that's how this podcast goes forward. If you want to join any of those, you know how to get the sponsors. If you want to join the Patreon, go to our website, fastlifegarage.com. It's $1 a month. You know, if that's all you can swing, then fuck it, man. I appreciate it. It's going to help us do things. And in the meantime, we're doing exclusive content, and we're constantly trying to figure out new ways to grow that community within that so that you guys get more. I have not resorted to sending nudes there yet, but I'm getting close, so we'll see how that goes. You don't want to see any of that. Anyway, we're getting ready for Sturgis, man. It's coming down to the wire. We got a couple paint jobs to knock out and a couple of my own bike to kind of throw some parts on and get some shit done to it so I can ride it. So looking forward to telling you all about this new bike and how that went down in a future podcast when it's applicable. And we'll get into that then. But until then, man, you guys have a good week. And thanks for checking us out. We'll see you on the next one. Peace.